down the hall just to the right-hand side. Also, if you are parked here at the Hale Koa, you can validate your parking ticket right outside, available at the table. In case of an emergency, please exit the room calm and orderly, and please follow the exit signs that are marked in green. For your awareness, this session is being video recorded. This footage will be shared on Alelo for broadcast at a later date. Lastly, I'd ask you, if you have any cell phones or electronic devices with you, please put them on silent or vibrate at this time. With me on stage to my right is Major General Charlie Flynn, who is the commanding general of the 25th Infantry Division at Schofield Barracks, and who also serves as the commander, U.S. Army Hawaii. And to his right are two individuals from the Department of the Army headquarters at the Pentagon. Mr. John McLaurin, Deputy Director for the Department of the Army Force Management Office. Also with the Force Management Office tonight is Colonel Tom O'Donoghue. Thank you for traveling here to Hawaii to hear us and from our Hawaiian leaders and our community participants. At this time, I'd like to call on Kahu Kaleo Patterson to provide a traditional blessing on our session. Sir.
And yes, gracious God, home of our spirits, we thank you so much for this beautiful day. And now as the sun is setting, we gather here this evening as the community of this land, this precious land of Hawaii. And we thank you for all of the members of our community that are here tonight for this very important listening session. And we ask that you come and be with us and give us clear minds and pure hearts to listen as clearly as we can, but then also to respond in the ways that are important to us. And we just thank you for this opportunity again to be together and to envision the future that we have here. And so we pray for all your mercies, all your blessings, and the new beginning that we desire. Makainua o kamakua a meke keiki a meka uhani mulele. Amen. Amen.
Mahalo. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time I'd like General Flynn to welcome us and provide remarks on the purpose of this community listening session. General Flynn, sir.
Aloha.
Aloha.
Well, listen, first of all, I want to thank everybody and ikomo mai to everyone that has arrived here tonight for taking time out of your lives, out of your schedules to share a few hours together or whatever time you can spend here to have a conversation. We have great representation across all the community members that are here with us tonight, and many dignitaries in the audience. Governor Ige, I appreciate you taking time and being here with us tonight. I won't attempt to name all of the various dignitaries that are here tonight because it'll lead up a little bit of time, and I probably regrettably miss some of those who are in attendance that I simply can't see throughout the room. But I do want to sincerely thank each of you and everyone here tonight for this exceptional turnout. And we hope to have the same thing tomorrow night up at Leilua High School with many of you and from another group of folks across the island. But most importantly, I just want to express to everybody tonight that this is really a session for you and for us to listen to your word. As many of you know, due to federal budget cuts, the Army is currently reducing its active duty force from a wartime peak of 567,000 in 2010 to 490,000 soldiers by September 30th of this year. Due to additional budget cuts known as sequestration, beginning this October, the Army may face further reductions of at least another 40,000 and possibly another 30,000 beyond that. So as you might imagine, this is going to necessitate significant realignment to the Army's structure so that it can continue to best meet our nation's critical defense needs. Every Army installation has the potential to be reduced. So in the event that sequestration is not averted, in the worst case scenario, it could possibly mean a reduction of 19,800 soldiers and Army civilian employees and approximately 30,000 Army family members living in Hawaii. As a result of these looming decisions, the Department of the Army headquarters is conducting community listening sessions such as this one tonight and at 30 installations similar to Schofield Barracks and Shafter. And those are other locations where they could face larger cuts. These sessions began in November and thus far have been held in 10 installations to include Fort Campbell, Fort Stewart, and Joint Base Lewis-McChord, just to name a few. The sessions will continue through March of this year for the remainder of the 30 installations. In fact, Mr. McLaurin has been to a couple of those installations, so he's been a few other rounds in some other locations important to the Army. It's important to note that while there could be impacts at as many of the 30 installations, Army installations under review, nothing has been decided by Army or political leadership at this time, and it's expected to be mid-2015 before any decisions are finally announced. The Army's been part of the fabric of Hawaii for over 116 years, and it's as important today as it's ever been. If we look at the Pacific region, it's comprised of 36 nations covering more than half the globe, and it contains 7 of the world's 10 largest armies. The Pacific region contains 3 of the largest economies and 6 of the most populous nations in the world. The Army conducts in excess of 200 engagements each year with the 34 partnered countries throughout the Pacific. And in 2012, the United States renewed its commitment to the region when President Obama signed the Defense Strategic Guidance, directing a national rebalance towards the Pacific, special emphasis on preserving peace, stability, and working as partners in this dynamic and challenging region. Together with our sister services here in Hawaii, the Army's been able to strengthen Pacific partnerships and alliances that will prevent future conflicts and protect national economic interests. Since 9/11, Hawaii soldiers have played a vital role in homeland defense for Hawaii, Alaska, Guam, and America Samoa, as well in support of operations with our allies throughout the region. The Army is the largest military service in Hawaii with over 22,500 active duty soldiers, which comprises 44% of all the active military forces based in the state. We're proud of our contributions to Hawaii, both past and present, and our soldiers and families who are also contributing members of the Hawaiian communities. As I mentioned earlier, this is your meeting. The Army is very interested in understanding the impacts that potential force cuts would have on the local Hawaiian economy, jobs, quality of life, medical care, transportation, roads, and the education system, and many, many others. Mr. McLaurin and Colonel O'Donohue and my team are here to listen. We're going to listen intently to everything you have to say. And remember, they're taking your comments back to the Pentagon to ensure that what you say here tonight is taken into consideration by decision makers. So if you have noteworthy points or unique items that set this community and state apart from others, I would strongly encourage you to make those comments here tonight. I only ask that you follow our guidelines, and Colonel Faulkner will go cover those in a few minutes, but the two basic rules would be Let's remain respectful of one another's position, and we're here to listen and not have a question and answer session. So in closing, I'd just like to say thank you very much once again for all the support that you've offered. As I said earlier, for taking time out of your schedules to be here and share this moment with us and share this this session so we can hear from the community and from the leaders within the community and from many of you who care about the state of the Army and the state of Hawaii. Thank you very much, and Tim, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, General Flynn. At this time, I'd like to call Mr. McLaurin to address us, sir.
Well, aloha.
Aloha.
I am particularly pleased to be here tonight with you because I have a strong affection for Hawaii, having been here multiple times, both in uniform and as a civilian. I appreciate all that Hawaii has to offer, not only to the general population, but also to the national security of the United States of America. I'm here to collect on behalf of the Secretary of the Army and the Chief of Staff of the Army your comments. When we started these listening sessions, it actually started in 2013 with that first programmatic environmental assessment. The Secretary was concerned that members of the community at large at those locations that potentially could be affected had an opportunity to actually speak to someone about their concerns. We have continued that process now with the supplemental PEA, which covers many more troops and covers many more locations. I look forward to hearing those comments and to taking them back. I will personally be responsible for communicating those concerns and comments back to the Chief and to the Secretary. It is my office that will be putting those packages together and responsible for actually speaking with them, so you will definitely have a voice. That said, I would encourage everybody in attendance that this really is your opportunity and the occasion for you to actually have a voice in what happens with regard to decisions that have to be made in the Army, depending on what budgets come to the Army. We have tonight and we have tomorrow night. Please feel free to communicate with us. We appreciate the fact that you're here. We appreciate the fact that you have allowed us to come here into your communities and listen to your comments. So thank you again. Look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, sir. At this time, I'd like to call on Colonel Tom Donahue, who will cover the headquarters of the Department of the Army process in his slide presentation.
Thank you very much, everybody, for coming here. It's always humbling, and it's particularly humbling seeing, you know, people taking time out of their day to come to this session, and I personally greatly appreciate that. Thank you for that. Today's session really has two purposes. The first, which I'm going to try to cover in the next, I think, six slides, is just to give you some information on the Army's process, how the Army's going to make its decision. Second purpose is the more important, and that is to actually hear from you. I think that's been well covered already, so I'll get right into trying to explain the process. Next slide, please. I think just a brief roadmap where I'm going to go, so rather than spend time on it, I am just going to get right into it. So next slide, please. Okay. First slide. So what's happened so far? Because as most people know, the programmatic environmental assessment is a supplemental environmental a supplement to the 2013 PA. So here's what's happened. In June of 2013, the Army announced its plans to reduce from a wartime high of roughly 570,000 soldiers down to 490,000 soldiers, approximately 80,000 soldiers. The decisions were made. That is underway now, and that will achieve 490,000 soldiers in October. For the most part, Hawaii was not affected by those decisions. But it is worth highlighting that those reductions, that there was a fair amount of slack in the system that led to those reductions, and that largely mitigated the impact, which again, you know, Hawaii was not impacted by the decisions. In particular, of the 80,000 soldiers, about 50,000 positions were reduced, were not part of the Army end strength in the United States. So they weren't stationed at any particular installation. Approximately 11,000 soldiers came out of Europe, and another 32,000 soldiers were part of a temporary end strength and a wartime allowance that was necessary to plus up units that were going to Iraq and to Afghanistan. The reason why I bring that up is to let you know that this round, there is that slack doesn't exist. So any reductions from 490,000 to 450 or 420 will come out of force structure that's actually stationed. I think it'll be felt a lot more. Next slide, please. So after cutting 80,000 soldiers, you know, the question is, why are we back? Why are we gearing up for another round of reductions? We're not even done cutting the 80,000, and here we are again. Well, we're here because the impact of the Budget Control Act didn't end with the reduction of those 80,000 soldiers. There's a second round, kind of a kicker, called sequestration, which is part of the Budget Control Act. And under sequestration, the Army's budget will be reduced by an additional $95 billion. So the question is, okay, what does this mean in terms of end strength? The Quadrennial Offense Review 2014 laid it out very clearly in very clear numbers. It says that the Army will reduce its end strength to 450,000 soldiers by FY17, and under full sequestration, if it continues, the Army will draw down to 420,000 soldiers by fiscal year 2019. Next slide. Next slide really just discusses the fact that we didn't anticipate this magnitude of cuts. So we did our program environmental assessment, made some announcements back in June of 2013. We didn't anticipate cuts to that magnitude. So we were looking at a 490,000 end strength Army. Now we're forced to do a supplement in order to look at cuts at 450 and then as low as 420,000. Next slide, please. Okay, well, no briefing from the Pentagon is going to be complete without at least one of these kinds of slides. So, you know, I had to get in there, so yeah, here it is. It's not quite as bad as it looks. So I'd like to just talk through it really quick, because this is the Army's process. How does the Army decide where it's going to, you know, take troops, where it's going to cut troops? In the upper left-hand side, if you can actually read that there, you'll see that the Army doesn't start off with a blank slate. There's a lot of factors that are given to, a lot of information that's given to the Army. We get input from the budget, Budget Control Act, Quadrennial Defense Review, there's total Army analysis, there's all sorts of strategic guidance. It tells the Army a lot of what it's going to do. Moving along to the upper center, you can see the environmental and socioeconomic impact that we've done. That is part of the process. We look at those factors as well. Next, in the upper right hand, you'll see information from today's session. Community input, listening session input will be part of the decision process, and that's what we're here tonight to gather. The Army also considers the military value analysis, which I'll talk about on the next slide, which also happens to be the last slide, so I'm very happy about that. And we also look at some other factors, you know, strategic considerations, and it becomes all part of the decision process. All this information goes up through a series of general officer steering committees, the one-star level, two-star level, three-star level, the ultimate decision being made by the Secretary of the Army and the Chief of Staff of the Army. Okay, next slide, please. So in closing, here's a summary of the factors that the Army considers in this process. First, the military value analysis model. It looks at the factors that are important to a brigade combat team, and, you know, including training assets, training availability, the ability, project force, or power projection capabilities, and soldier well-being. But beyond the MVA, the military value analysis model, there's other things we look at. Strategic considerations are a central part of the decision process. We need to make sure that we have the right forces in the right place based on the threats the nation faces today and will face in the future. Cost and efficiencies, that's always a factor. I mean, money always matters, but it matters quite a bit when you don't have much. So at this time, you know, cost and efficiencies are another factor. And then there's other factors, including readiness, statutory requirements, and feasibility. Next slide, please. So now that you have an idea of the factors that you know, go into the Army's decision process, I'd like to give a session over to you to learn what information, what messages you would like us to carry back to the Pentagon and to the decision makers. Thank you very much for your time.
Now we'll begin hearing from our elected officials who are here tonight. And we will also have received video messages from our congressional delegation who are unable to attend due to commitments in Washington, D.C. Our first elected official is the Honorable David Ige, Governor of the State of Hawaii.
Thank you very much, Mr. McLaren and the rest of the listening team. We really do appreciate the U.S. Army deciding to come to Hawaii so that you can hear the voices from our communities. We really do applaud that effort in order to give the most affected communities the opportunity to really share with you the concerns that we have. It is an honor to be here on behalf of the people of Hawaii. The U.S. Army has become such an integral part of our communities, going back from before statehood all the way through the current day. There are soldiers have become such an integrated part of our communities, from education to businesses. It really affects each and every part of our community. And being the most geographically isolated community on the planet, I think the impact of the force reductions on Hawaii is significantly magnified because there is no other community other than the state of Hawaii. I do have a proclamation here declaring January 27th and 28th as Save Hawaii's Heroes Day that we executed with Lieutenant Governor Tsutsui, just as an expression of our concern and our commitment to be, for the state of Hawaii to be a strong partner with the U.S. Army in hopes of expressing our commitment. I cannot tell you what a difference on a young child's face when a soldier shows up in uniform to read to our children as part of our literacy program. Most importantly, your Army forces have engaged in partnership with our public school system all throughout the community, and it clearly makes a big difference. Beyond that, I would just like to share a personal story with you. You know, when I graduated as an electrical engineer from the University of Hawaii, I did have many job offers. Most of them were on the mainland. I had one job offer from a local company to do work on Ford Island for Commander 3rd Fleet. The military presence, the U.S. Army presence in Hawaii is more than just the women and soldiers who serve the Army. There is significant impact throughout our community, giving our young people and many others the opportunities of a lifetime to pursue careers in building their families and future here in our islands. And I just wanted to express that to you personally. The proclamation does talk about the statistical impact of the reduction in terms of our business and your business impact in the islands that I would like to share and offer for you to the record. I do want to again close by thanking you for spending time here. We do know that you will learn a lot from our community about the impact that the U.S. Army has here in Hawaii. So thank you very much for this opportunity.
And now we'll go to Aloha, Senator Schatz.
Good evening. My duties in the Senate prevented me from being with you to deliver these remarks in person tonight, but I welcome the opportunity to provide this testimony as the Army considers decisions affecting the future of the force here in Hawaii. I am strongly opposed to the cuts to the United States Army Garrison Hawaii. Hawaii is the last place the Army should consider cutting soldiers in light of America's commitment to rebalance to the Asia Pacific. There's bipartisan consensus that this rebalance is right for our country. If resourced correctly, the Army can play a strategic role, with Hawaii as the foundation for its engagement in the region. After U.S. Army Korea, Hawaii is home to the Army's most forward soldiers, capable of responding to crises in a fraction of the time compared to those in Washington and California. Our tropical environment is the perfect training location to prepare the Army for the Asia Pacific, making soldiers here more ready for this region and forces based on the mainland. And our mountain and desert training areas ensure that these soldiers are prepared to deploy anywhere in the world. The Army faces hard choices as it shrinks to 450,000 soldiers after more than a decade of open-ended war. And Congress is making these choices harder as it continues to threaten sequestration that could force the Army to shrink even further. Congress must remove the threat of these arbitrary, across-the-board spending cuts so that Army leaders can improve their planning and avoid these strategically unwise decisions. Today's world increasingly demands that the military be prepared to operate as a joint force, and there are a few places that are better suited for training to operate together than Hawaii. When soldiers on Oahu deploy for training exercise in the region, they often do so with the support of the Air Force. Marines train alongside the Army at Schofield Barracks and at the Pohakuloa training area on the Big Island. All of this helps to develop the discipline that makes it easier to work together in the real world. To support the Army in Hawaii, community leaders have worked closely with the garrison to accommodate its training requirements. These relationships took decades to develop and have not been without tension on contentious issues, particularly over the use of historically, culturally, and environmentally sensitive land for training. But these relationships have matured into a close partnership that has helped to ensure that training is in balance with local needs, like at the Pohakuloa training area, where there is now a staff dedicated to preserving and protecting endangered plants and Native Hawaiian cultural resources. The Army cannot allow the budget to drive its strategy in this critically important region. The people of Hawaii and the soldiers here have always worked together to support our national defense, and we'll continue to do so. Mahalo.
Next video will be from Senator Hirono.
Aloha. I want to thank you all for being here today and for participating in this important listening session. I appreciate the Army providing Hawaii the opportunity to ensure our voices are heard, and the Military Affairs Council of the Chamber of Commerce of Hawaii for reaching out to the community. I also want to thank the men and women of our armed forces and their families who serve our nation so honorably. Because of your sacrifices, our nation remains free and safe. Today, I join my fellow members of Hawaii's congressional delegation, state and county elected officials, Governor Ige and Mayor Caldwell, and other leaders in our community who support the military's current force structure in Hawaii. Keeping our military strong in Hawaii is vital and requires all of our full efforts working together. While I am not able to be with you in person, I have seen your schedule and all the Army representatives participating. Thank you. I know your time in Hawaii is brief, but you are getting a sharp and clear picture of the importance this community places on our relationship with the military. The battle in Washington, D.C. over how to address sequestration is real. As a member of the Senate Armed Services Committee, I have heard directly from our nation's military leaders about how sequestration has negatively impacted our military's readiness. Our national economy is improving, and we have cut the deficit significantly. As far as I'm concerned, we should eliminate the sequester. We've already seen in real life how devastating and serious these cuts were, and the cuts that will come in 2016 will be much worse. The 2016 sequester was and is a huge concern to both the outgoing chair of the Senate Armed Services Committee, Senator Carl Levin, and the new chair, Senator John McCain. Serious to all of our committee members and our military leaders. We know that sequestration cuts compromise our military's readiness and therefore threaten a prime mission of our military. I want you to know that I am working with my colleagues in the Senate Armed Services Committee to curtail these cuts before they do further damage, including the negative impact on the rebalance to the Asia-Pacific. Pacific Command, PACOM, covers more than 50% of the world's population, including some of the largest militaries and economies of the world. It is critically important we stay focused on this region. As the nation rebalances to the Asia-Pacific theater, I continue to raise with Pentagon officials and my Senate colleagues the strategic importance of Hawaii to our force structure in the Pacific. The Army, along with the Navy, Marine Corps, and Air Force, have long known and valued the importance of a forward presence in this theater. Having soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines trained and ready here in Hawaii is vital for our nation to be prepared to face potential national security threats. The President knows this. The top brass at the Pentagon know this. And this is the Army's listening session, so of course, General Brooks knows this. I know that Admiral Harris, Admiral Locklear, General Robinson, General Tulin, and all of our other military leaders here, and all of you know this. In addition to the strategic necessity of maintaining ready forces in Hawaii, we all know that the military has a significant social and economic impact in our local communities. For example, there are over 22,000 active duty Army in Hawaii, plus their families. Annual Army active duty and civilian payrolls total nearly $1.5 billion in Hawaii. Yes, $1.5 billion. With a B. Military activity in Hawaii is one of the two most important economic drivers in our state. Over the years, I've met with many military families in Hawaii. These families have homes, spend money in our stores, and eat in our restaurants. They are part of our local community, in schools, organizations, churches, and more. As a member of the Senate Armed Services Committee, I've made clear to our military leaders and my colleagues Hawaii's important role in the rebalance of the Asia-Pacific. I will continue to press our military leaders on this point. I will certainly discuss these concerns when I meet with Ash Carter this week, President Obama's nominee for Secretary of Defense. Thank you for this opportunity to share my input on the critical need to ensure the military maintains its current force structure in Hawaii. Thank you again to all of you for participating in this important listening process. I will work with you to ensure our voices are heard. And most importantly, once again, I thank our military men and women and their families who sacrifice and serve our nation. Aloha.
Next is Congresswoman Gabbard.
Aloha and mahalo to all of you for attending today's public listening session regarding the potential downsizing at Schofield Barracks in Fort Shafter. As you know, the issue before us today is a very serious one. These two military installations are critical, not only for Hawaii's economy, but to the national military strategic posture of the United States. Importantly, the Army's presence in Hawaii has always been rooted in the significance of Hawaii's geographic location. Nowhere else in the world is it so clear that our economic and national security interests are deeply impacted by potential threats arising in the Asia-Pacific region. The United States Army's mission, executed from Hawaii's geographically strategic location, forms the backbone of the U.S. strategy in the Asia-Pacific region. However, we are presented with difficult choices, largely as a result of the Budget Control Act of 2011. In my opinion, these blunt, across-the-board sequester cuts, which provide no flexibility, are not good policy, and we're seeing exactly why here today. The worst-case scenario that's facing us is the removal of 19,800 service members and civilians from Hawaii. That's 3,800 from Fort Shafter and 16,000 from Schofield Barracks, and an associated 30,000 family members. The estimated impact of this removal would be a decrease of 5% of Honolulu's population and a $1.35 billion hit to Hawaii's economy. Such drastic action would create a ripple effect for defense and military spending in our state, which makes up 18% of our economy. While there is an obvious need for economic diversification, and we must continue to strive for that, that goal must be pursued in tandem with keeping our strongest industries productive. A loss of this magnitude would also mean crippling impacts to the unique and indispensable assets available to Pacific Command for regional security and stability. The loss of Army forces stationed in Hawaii would fundamentally undermine current efforts to build a sustainable U.S. military presence in the Asia-Pacific region, and it would limit our ability to build relationships proactively with partner countries, to build those friendships which really promote stability in the region. This forum here today is how you make your voices heard. No matter what side of this debate you fall on, I appreciate that you took the time to come out today because your attendance is an exercise of civic duty and is essential for all of us. The questions surrounding the potential downsizing are significant to our community. I wish I could be with you there today as you discuss an important part of our state's future with so much at stake. I'm listening to your concerns about the implications of these potential cuts at Schofield and at Fort Shafter, and I encourage you to contact me personally with any further questions or concerns that you may have. Aloha, and I wish you a productive listening session today.
Aloha, this is Congressman Mark Takai speaking to you from Washington, D.C. I apologize for not being able to attend in person, as I know how important these listening sessions are for the community. As your newest member of Congress, I'm already putting aside the partisan gridlock that has plagued Congress for too long and getting right to work. My first week in Congress climaxed with a key appointment to the House Armed Services Committee. Among my priorities during my time in Washington is the preservation of military force structure in Hawaii. Defense spending in Hawaii makes up around 18% of the state's economy and affects every other economic sector. So while I agree that we need to search for ways to diversify our economy, a gradual transition is necessary, which makes it crucially important to preserve what we have now. Across-the-board spending cuts will return in 2016 and beyond, forcing the military to make tough decisions about where and when it will sustain the reductions. The Army must cut its overall force structure by almost 80,000 to achieve the savings required by the Budget Control Act of 2011. While a last-minute budget deal staved off some of the most harmful cuts in 2014 and 15, We cannot anticipate these last-minute solutions to continue if we only kick the can down the road. Last year, the Army outlined the Army Force Structure 2020 Realignment Initiative. Though no final decision has been made, a worst-case scenario was laid out that would be catastrophic for Hawaii. This option would result in a reduction of almost 20,000 soldiers and civilians from Fort Shafter and Schofield Barracks, along with another 30,000 of their family members. The communities on the west side of Oahu, around Schofield Barracks, would lose approximately 30% of their population, causing an annual economic loss to the state of about $1.35 billion. Cuts like this would be harmful for Hawaii's economy, put many communities around these bases at risk, and be out of line with our recently adjusted national defense strategy. Let me say this to the Army leadership and to everyone listening in the audience. We need the Army to stay put, not only for the economic benefits of our communities, but for the overall security of the nation. I understand how the Army evaluates locations to place force structure on costs, ability to train, and overall support for the community. Through my seat on the House Armed Services Committee, I'm committed to working with you to make sure that Hawaii is on top of all of these objectives. I'll continue to work with everyone in the delegation to ensure that we save money where we can. We plan to focus on responsible, efficient initiatives that will cut wasteful spending. These efficiencies can then serve as an alternative to these tough choices without harming our national security and putting our state's communities at risk. The Army must continue to use the strategic location of Hawaii to serve its needs. The Obama administration has announced the rebalance to the Asia Pacific, and Hawaii is the perfect place to ensure that our troops are ready to meet the challenges of this arena. Hawaii is the only place in the United States where Army troops can train in canopy jungle, which is evidenced by the recent resurrection of the Jungle Operations Training Course around Oahu. This will lead to a more responsive and prepared force in the Pacific Theater. Puakaloa Training Area on the Big Island provides the ability to train large maneuver brigades in live fire exercises, and we're currently looking at ways to reduce the cost of training there and everywhere else in Hawaii. While we have had challenges in the past, I am optimistic about the future. Military leadership and community leaders put our heads together, we have made a lot of progress. I have heard from many of my constituents in Hawaii, and the verdict is clear. We want the Army to stay. Know that I will continue to pledge my unwavering support for meeting the challenges of the 21st century with the Army in Hawaii. Hawaii is your home. Stay put. Mahalo for the opportunity to speak to you today. Aloha.
Our next elected official, the Honorable Kirk Caldwell, Mayor of the City and County of Honolulu.
Good evening and aloha.
Aloha.
It's so good to have our folks from the Army here today. And it's great to have our folks from our community today here. So many people came into Waikiki. Not an easy place to get into, not an easy place to get out of. And you came here because you care and you love our community. No matter where you stand on the issue, I want to thank all of you for showing that you do care and you love this place. I wanted to tell you a story. You've heard a lot about the impact of any cutbacks on our bases at both Schofield and Fort Shafter. But I wanted to tell you about making a lei. I brought a lei with me. This is a simple plumeria lei. It's my favorite. It's the one that I got when I was a kid back in the 50s. only cost a couple bucks in Chinatown. It's not the tantaran lei that you give when you want to impress your girlfriend. But it smells great, and it looks great, and it represents Hawaii. And when folks make lei, you got to go out and pick the flowers yourself. With, you know, your fingers, you're picking these flowers. As you're picking the flowers, you're thinking about who you're going to give this lei to. And as you string the flowers onto the string, you're thinking about the lei that you're going to, the person you're going to give the lei to. And Hawaiians will say they're putting their mana, their feeling, their emotion into this lei. As you know, lei and Hawaii go together. And those who arrive on our shores get lei. When they leave, they get lei. When we get married and at special occasions, we deliver lei. And Kahu here can talk much better about this than I ever could. But I've learned by listening to Kahu and others talk. In Hawaii, we have a very unique thing. Every Memorial Day, around this state, people pick flowers and string lei on every island. They do it on this island and deliver, they pick flowers and they deliver it to every fire station. And lei are sown at those stations. They bring flowers to Honolulu Hale, our city hall. Hale means house. They string lei there. And they do it on every other island, and the lei are delivered here to Oahu. And they're put on the graves of those who gave their last full measure of devotion, as Abraham Lincoln talked about in the Gettysburg Address, who are buried in Punchbowl. Every single grave gets a lei, 40,000. How does that happen? It's a completely voluntary effort by the people of this community, because we love our military. And we recognize the sacrifice that you make, both those who gave their last full measure of devotion and those who sit on the stage today, who put their lives on the line when they serve on the front line, away from your loved ones. And it is a huge sacrifice. We recognize that, and we try to return the aloha through this volunteer effort. And this morning I mentioned, you know, we are unique in Hawaii. Punchbowl is the only national cemetery in the United States. We have Arlington, which is the national cemetery. There's only one other one, and that's in Europe, at Omaha Beach in Normandy. And for anyone who's gone to any one of these three cemeteries, it is chicken skin in terms of its beauty, its peace, its silence, and what it speaks and the stories that it tells. And that story is alive and well here in our community in Honolulu. I think just in the time since I first ran for office for the State House, when the Iraq War started in Afghanistan. And as our troops are sent, Marines from Kaneohe and troops from Schofield, things got quiet in these communities, really quiet. The businesses in our communities fell quiet. They didn't do very well. Some had to shut their doors and file bankruptcy. But neighbors fell quiet too, because their friends left. And they left behind spouses and children who are sad and worried and scared. And we reached out to give them love, formed organizations, but we felt the impact of that in very dramatic ways. And it's just a small example, I think, of what we'd feel if you were to cut 16,000 people out of Schofield and almost 4,000 out of Shafter. The same kind of silence would fall, and the impact would be deafening to this community. We love what you do. We recognize the importance, and we believe that, particularly in Hawaii, we serve an incredible, important function. And we want to make sure that it stays healthy and strong by you maintaining the troop strength that you have today. Now, some may argue, and I'm interested because I'm very interested in trying to find more affordable housing, that if we had a reduction, that spaces on base would become available for housing. And yet, we look at Kalaeloa and Barbers Point and the shutting down of that base over a decade ago. And any of us who drive out there today will see crumbling infrastructure, barracks that are falling down, banyan trees growing out of the sides of walls, keawe trees growing out of parking lots. and wasting assets. It's a tragedy. And both the city and the state have been offered parts of that base under the condition that should we take it, we have to improve the infrastructure, sewer and water. For the city's portion, it's almost $1 billion. We're just working hard to find more money for our rail project. And so we have not touched that. We have not touched that as much as it's a beautiful asset. But it costs a lot of money to do this. And my point that I'm making is that while people may think automatically you
he's
get
a true politician, this dude.
Part of a base back, it's not that simple. And I think the economic impact of losing these troops, $1.3 billion out of a $14.7 billion budget, almost as large as tourism, is something that I don't think this island can afford, nor do we want in any way. So we've worked really hard. Carol Kai and I teamed up to be co-chairs of Keep Our Hawaii Heroes, because you are our heroes, and we want to keep you. We worked really hard because some of the folks on the mainland also had petition drives and did pretty well. But we worked during the holidays when most people are out there partying, celebrating, opening Christmas presents, going to New Year's parties. Folks in this room went all over this island and around this state gathering signatures. And we have here today 41,056 signatures and climbing that we want to deliver to you. Where are those boxes? Can we bring them over? No? I want to bring them over. Well, I want to put delay. This is for all of you.
Is it addressed to
where is that? No, let's bring them over here. Huh? You cannot? Oh, they say you cannot. All right. Well, we got the boxes over here to deliver you.
Your 2 minutes
up. And we hope that you'll be able to take them back to Washington. You have a plane or two that you can put them on, right? But I did want to thank you all to show you that we have walked the walk, not just talked it. I think the people of this community have spoken loud and clear that we want you to stay here. We want you to stay in the true strength that you have here. We want to show you the love that we've demonstrated to you through many, many decades and show you our appreciation by working together as one community for a stronger Hawaii and a stronger America. Thank you so much. We love all of you. Thank you so much, everyone.
Next is the Honorable Will Aspero, Vice President of the Hawaiian Senate.
Public safety.
Good evening and aloha.
Aloha.
Deputy Secretary McLaren, Major General Flynn, Colonel Donahue, and Colonel Faulkner. First, I'd like to state that I'm from a proud military family. My father served 21 years in the United States Navy. My brother served 4 years in the U.S. Army. Currently, I have a son who is a captain in the United States Marine Corps, deployed with the Black Sea Rotational Forces now. And I am the chairman of the Public Safety, Intergovernmental, and Military Affairs in the Hawaii Senate. The 28th legislature convened last Wednesday on the 21st. And one of the first resolutions that both the Senate and the House passed is the resolution that I distributed before you. You have Senate Concurrent Resolution number 3. And at this time, I'd like to read this so that you and others can hear the importance of the Army. Whereas, as part of its 2024 structure realignment, the United States Army is currently considering a proposal to eliminate 16,606 active duty soldiers from Schofield Barracks and 3,786 active duty soldiers from Fort Shafter on the island of Oahu. And whereas our nation's rebalance to the Pacific has real consequence to Hawaii because our state's economic security is directly linked to our national security. And whereas today, more than $9 billion has been spent to reposition assets and capabilities into the Asia-Pacific region. And whereas the United States Army, United States military has signed a defense cooperation agreement with the Philippines, place two additional U.S. Navy destroyers in and deploy tilt rotor Osprey aircraft and Global Hawk drones to Japan, and the Marine Corps is removing troops in Australia as plans move forward to relocate Marines from Okinawa, Japan to Guam and then Hawaii. And whereas North Korea is a notoriously unpredictable and dangerous nation, and China's aggressive military growth, its lack of transparency, and its pattern of increasingly assertive behavior in the region make the need for a visible American presence all the more important, with Hawaii as a critical forward deployment location. And whereas the United States Pacific Pathways Plan to strengthen capabilities and assets in the Pacific region is an integral part of our national defense strategy, and whereas a reduction in Hawaii-based troops will undermine the priority placed on a strong boots-on-the-ground presence in the Pacific region, and whereas the number of active-duty soldiers and civilians on Oahu will be reduced by at least 19,800 due to the proposed force reduction, which will result in a reduction of approximately 30,000 civilian family members. And whereas the force reduction will reduce Oahu's total population by 5% and will affect and reduce by 38% the populations of the communities surrounding Schofield Barracks, including Mililani, Waiawa, Wailua, and Kunia. And whereas such a population loss will severely impact the local construction, retail, and real estate industries, and professional scientific and technical services by estimated loss of 20,000 jobs. And whereas the total economic impact of the proposed force reduction will greatly hurt Hawaii's economy due to an estimated payroll loss of $1.5 billion, a loss of $400 million in military construction funding, and an estimated loss of $9,200,000 in general excise tax revenues. And whereas the proposed reduction will adversely affect the population, economy, and schools of Central Oahu and Honolulu communities as a whole, now therefore be it resolved by the 28th Legislature that the legislature strongly opposes the United States Army's 2020 force reduction realignment proposal as it affects Schofield Barracks and Fort Shafter located on the island of Oahu. The leaders of the Pentagon and President Barack Obama often speak of the Asia-Pacific pivot and the need for a strong military in our global situation. Obviously, with this pivot, Hawaii is an integral part of our nation's defense. And unless we plan on maybe battling Canada and Mexico, in the event there is a sequestration, and in the worst case scenario, the presence of our military in Hawaii should be exempt, and we should not be a part of any sequestration. It's obvious that with this forward deployment, we are the closest to the potential hotspots that will impact our world. And we ask you to consider all of the testimonies tonight and consider the importance of our nation's security. Thank you and aloha.
Next, the Honorable Gilbert Kahili.
Hello, Major General Flynn, Lieutenant General 25th Infantry Division, Mr. John McLaughlin, Colonel Thomas Donahue, and distinguished guests. I'm State Senator Gil Kahili, and I represent District 1 on Hawaii Island, Hilo, the city by the bay. I'm here to testify in support of the U.S. Army's continued presence in Hawaii. I served 4 years in the United States Marine Corps. In 2000, I retired after 37 years as a civilian employee, Department of Defense, with 25 years Waikiki training area in the Public Works Division. Partnerships with the military is essential, not just for the immediate jobs that the military's presence in Hawaii creates, but also because it is essential to the state's workforce development strategy moving forward. Military installations require a wide range of technical and construction skill sets and serve as a consistent customer base to ensure that we retain highly skilled workers in state. The military also supports Hawaii's efforts to be at the forefront of emerging technologies and innovation. We are serious about continuing to provide our children with jobs and remain committed to mitigating the brain drain, quote unquote, that we need a strong military presence in Hawaii. Proposed cuts to personnel at Schofield and Shafter would have a dramatic impact, not only on our economy, but on future employment and training opportunities for Hawaii's residents. Hawaii has traditionally been and continue to be a strategic location through which our troops surge during crisis. The state of Hawaii has limited workforce reserves to support these surges, and the proposed downsizing could critically diminish the state's ability to respond in such situations. On Hawaii Island, the emerging partnerships between Waikiki and educational institutions and businesses is creating opportunities for cutting-edge aviation and unmanned systems programs to be developed, for which there are no other viable locations in the Pacific arena. Hawaii has the Army's largest natural resource program to protect environmental and cultural resources and protects more than 100 threatened and endangered species. As witnessed recently during natural disasters in the Philippines, Hawaii, and in our islands, Hurricane Isel in Puna, and the lava flows, the military is a critical part of our disaster response infrastructure. Humanitarian and disaster relief capacity in Hawaii is critical in the most disaster-prone region of the world. There are a multitude of reasons why Hawaii's troops should not be downsized. Given my focus on workforce development, I wanted to highlight the importance of continuing to grow the established and future partnerships that support jobs, innovation, and emerging technologies that benefit the U.S. Army and the state of Hawaii. Thank you for allowing me to testify and express my opposition to the proposed downsizing of personnel at U.S. Army Garrison Hawaii. In closing, simplify.
Next, I'd like to have the Honorable Glenn Lakai.
Good question.
The culprit.
Save all the drugs. That's what the military industrial complex is.
All smoke.
Listen to Eisenhower.
Aloha. Thank you for that warm welcome. We're really here to collectively collaborate with.
Give us a chance to talk too. Come on.
I will keep my remarks to a minimum in respect for everyone's time here.
You got 3 minutes.
But I will like to say and focus particularly on Fort Shafter. My district is from Kalihi to Aloha Stadium, so I deal with the military on a regular basis, both at Hickam, Pearl Harbor, and at Fort Shafter. Fort Shafter is the oldest military base in Hawaii and sits on 590 acres in urban Honolulu. But beyond what has already been stated about the strategic and economic benefits, I'd like to talk about the gentle, kind hand that the military provides for all of us here in this room.
Contaminate the water.
They read to our children, they paint our schools, they they are a very important and positive influence on our community, and I think we should really be respectful of them being here and not focus on the negatives that some may have views on. I really like the motto that's on that apron about the U.S. Army of Hawaii, moving forward together. And here in Hawaii, we move forward together as family and ohana. I have a high school senior who's an intern in my office, and we talked today about the importance of and the ability for her to really thrive in Hawaii. She loves the ethnic diversity and the diversity of faces and opinions that we have here in the opinion that you might not find in some of your other locations. And I will kind of end my thoughts here by talking about the fact that the military presence here is so important to bridge that divide between the U.S. mainland and Hawaii. The patriotism that it courses through most of us here in this room, and when we see military personnel in uniform, it makes most of us have our chests swell with pride. And that, I think, is the value of the military's patriotism here and connecting us to the rest of the nation. And despite those who are speaking in the back of the room, I really, really appreciate, and I think I speak for many in my community, appreciate the contributions that the military has made for all of us here in the state.
People demanding me speak.
I apologize for the hila of all my friends over there. I apologize for that. And I'm proud that I'm a member of the 26th Division, and I salute the men of here. Enough has been said about this already, so I will not talk about it more. So please consider what the majority wants, not the loud minority. Thank you very much.
I'm speaking for 28,000 people who live in Hawaii, Kai. Thank you. Thank you very much for all of you. You will get your turn. You will get your turn. You will get your turn, sir. Okay, gentlemen. Mr. McLaren, General Carlos, thank you guys. Governor, Speaker Suki, Mayor, Honolulu. So I'm going to be very clear. I want to speak with three hats. I remember the House of Representatives. And did you know that we have the highest per capita number of veterans in the United States?
Let's
line
up to speak.
Line up to speak.
A lot of veterans here who have served the country, the highest in the state. So when we pull back, we not hurt only the people, but we hurt the veterans who are the core of the people of the state of Hawaii. As a member and the co-chair of the Small Business Caucus, the mom and pops that are going to get hurt by this is very clear. Now I'm going to take my hat off from the House of Representatives and put my U.S. Army hat on. I was a member of the Vietnam, I'm supposedly the only veteran, Vietnam veteran in the State House. I was a translator interpreter in Saigon. And I learned that the tail doesn't wag the dog strategically. As Senator Schott says, budget should not be the prevailing discussion of how you do a strategy. Right now, if we cut back our army, we're going to be the size of Burma and the size of Pakistan's army. Even Iran's army is bigger than us. So the whole point of cutting back to save money versus the strategy, you're never going to recreate Hawaii. You're never going to have the strategic position. Last statement, as a Peace Corps volunteer.
I served the humanitarian efforts in Malaysia as a volunteer, and I served as a Peace Corps country director in East Timor. I don't say that to say it about myself, but to say what you guys do in the Army for the humanitarian and disaster relief in the Pacific and Asia, the lives that you saved in Aceh, in Japan, in South America, that humanitarian effort is just invaluable. And if you pull back and you hold back that life-saving and goodwill, as you know, the diplomatic corps spoke very much in favor of this earlier this afternoon, the goodwill that we generate with the Army here is invaluable. So, gentlemen, my point is, do the right thing. Keep the military here. Let our heroes stay home. Thank you. Never.
Yes.
Good evening, everyone, and aloha. I come from the Big Island. Pakalua training area is in my district, so I just want to take a quick moment to say that what has not been talked about is your slide that really, it starts in 2011, and there was a lot of decisions made, but I think the message for me is the relationship we've had with the Army is not started in 2011. You have, and I do think that many people are here because they want you to know that those before you, there may be things that happened in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and the 60s. It's in a continuum. So whatever we do in the future, I think we want to be good partners. We want to make sure that whatever happens, you mitigate it. I saw on the slide that you were talking about doing environmental assessment. You were talking about the economic social impact and that you wanted to know what was happening with the environment. I think a lot of people, what I heard, was a lot of people saying they have concerns about Red Hill, about some of the ammunitions that were left, things that were before your time. So what we really want you to know is that I believe on Pakalua that you've been there for so many years, you've become the fabric of the community. If we agree with some of the stuff that you do or not, you are part of who we are. And what we want is that respectful, moving forward together in a respectful manner, listening manner, and that's what you're showing tonight. So I thank you so much for coming out and giving us a chance to listen, and I agree, let's hear from the people, and please let them know what you think. Thank you. Aloha.
The Honorable Linda Ichiyama, please.
If we could request an interruption from the politicians' parade, if we could have some people speak for another 10 speakers, could we have that as a compromise?
I would be willing to have somebody alternate with me, that's fine with me, and I can go afterwards, maybe?
Can we give three? Just please keep your comments as short as possible. We'll get through three more, and then we'll all kind of go over the rules here. Go ahead, Mark.
Okay. I'll keep my remarks short. I just wanted to say I'm here tonight as a member of the state legislature. My community is right next to Fort Shafter, but also as a member of the community. And as a person who is a direct beneficiary of the presence of the United States military in Hawaii. I'm the oldest of four children. My mom was a single mom. And I remember that because my dad wasn't around, it was really hard for us. And there were some times when my mom would come home and she would say, I don't know, we can't buy any more food for this week. We have to just eat what's in our cabinet for tonight. And my mom worked as a vice principal at Solomon Elementary School over at Schofield Barracks. If it wasn't for the presence of the military, I don't know that she would have had that kind of a job and would have been able to support the four of us and send three of us to college. So I'm an example of the effect the military presence has here, a very positive effect, and I'd just like to share that with you. Thank you.
Thank you. I have the Honorable Aaron Ling Johansson.
Some of us aren't paid to be here.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here, and I'll be very brief. I represent Fort Schaffter and many of the affected communities immediately around the Fort Schaffter and Pearl Harbor area. My family moved into the area in 1959 because my grandfather was a civilian ship fitter at Pearl Harbor. In fact, there during the second round of strafing, hiding under a wheelbarrow. So like many families in the area, we moved there specifically because of the draw of the military. I think much has been said about the positive aspects of the military, but I think the one aspect that I also wanted to point out that makes Hawaii uniquely suited to continue to host the military, not just the geographical terrain, but I think as the traditional gateway to Asia and with so many visitors from Asian countries, there's a unique ability for United States military members to be able to interact with a culture that they may be interacting with as they engage the broader Asia-Pacific theater. And that's something that can't always be taught in school. It's something that sometimes has to be learned through interaction with others. And I think that is a very unique benefit that Hawaii offers to our U.S. military as it continues to engage the Asia-Pacific theater. Thank you again.
Brigadier General Joe Logan, Adjutant General, Hawaii National Guard.
Thank you, last speaker. Governor Mayor, thank you. As the Adjutant General, I represent those of you in the community that are National Guard, whether you're Hawaii Army or Air National Guardsmen. We are here to support all of you, to take care of you in a disaster. And we rely on our military, the 25th Division, the U.S. Pacific Command, and the Pacific Air Forces, to keep us trained in our warfighting skills, which is our federal mission. But our state mission, more so, is to take care of all of you in a disaster. But we transition those skills in the military from our active counterparts to our civilian and law enforcement, our teachers, our community members, our business leaders, to help support all of you in a disaster.
But you're the disaster.
I beg your pardon, sir. I'm not a disaster.
You are the disaster.
We are here to help you in a disaster. And that's what we bring to you. So I just say to all of you, it's without them, we couldn't do what we do, and we're here to support all of you, so thank you very much.
So thank you. Okay, now we're here for the community input, and I appreciate your patience in coming out here. Before you open the floor, I've just asked a couple of guidelines. Show aloha, be kukua, okay? Please, as we get through all the speakers, let them be heard, because this is important for everyone here from the Headquarters Department of the Army team to listen to everyone, and everyone's view is important. It's not a question and answer session, but we're here to listen to you and take your comments, and we'll bring those back to Washington, D.C. Please try to keep it to the point, watch the time as much as possible, because we do have a quite large crowd tonight, and I know everyone wants to get through this. The other piece is, if you've already spoken, please allow others to speak. Again, we have a lot of folks that want to go. Sir, I'll start with you right here.
Hello, I.
It's on, sir.
Hello, I kako.
That means good evening to everyone in this room, if you don't know what that means. That is Hawaii. I am Ku Mo'oli. I am Mo'iali. I am Kamehameha 8. So I don't know how I didn't get on the number one list of yours with the resident politicians. My English name is Sir Lansanatha'ili Lincoln. That is my genealogy. I come from Kalaniopu, Kamehameha 1. I am the lonely one, always by myself. I come here to speak like the rest of these people for myself and my family. You know, the military, they take our country from us. It's time the military give our country back to us. I have no problem with military being in our Hawaiian islands, but you need to pay us to be here. You owe us back rent for being here for the last 116 years that you've been here. You have destroyed a lot of my sacred places here in the islands for my people. One is right up there in Schofield. Hale no longer there anymore. This ground here is very sacred. We are part of this land, sky, ocean. That is our people's way of life. We are all here as ohana, as family. You know, with the technology that you have today, you don't need boots on the ground. We can see that if you watch CNN. They just send a drone to blow people up. That's all you need now. You don't need boots on the ground. You don't need military men anymore. You can use machine like they do. When you go to the airport, you don't need to go see ticket person anymore. Just go to machine. See, military doing the same thing. They're using machines to kill. My people, we are not about killing. We are about aloha, which means love. All people, not just our people, but every other race that has made our land their home, including the military. We treat all with respect. That's all we want, is the same respect, please. Yes, we may lose a lot of money in the budget, but it's okay, we will survive. We Hawaiians are survivors. We raise our own fish in our lobbies. We grow taro. In our local year, we raise fish. Now, all these foreigners saying it was their idea. Please, our people been doing this before you even got here. A friend of mine from Washington State told me, Hawaii, you need to come to my state. I said, why? He said, because some brown people taught my people how to make canoes. You know who those brown people were? Hello? We had our own Navy before you people had a Navy. Only mistake Kamehameha did was he never keep that Navy going. Now we need to have you people help us form our own military to protect ourselves from you. Yeah. Not the Asians. See the Asians sitting right there? They all live here. Why are we gonna be afraid of them? They live with us. Thank you very much. Aloha, aloha.
Thank you, Thomas. Please, next mic, please. Thank you.
Hello? Aloha, my name is Kaniela. I just wanted to say thank you for being here, to the Army, also everyone from the community on both sides came out. I'd like to remind my fellow Hawaiians that of the value of ha'aha'a, that, you know, if you're raised Hawaiian, you know, that there's a time and place for anger, and there's a time and place for respect. First off, I wanted to talk about the history of Hawaii and the plantation history of Hawaii. It's a plantation history that has brought me here today. Our economy, from sandalwood to whaling to sugar to pineapple and all to military. We have often seen economic sunsets, but our people has always gotten together and seen new economies, new industries pop up every time. We have recovered and we will recover after the demilitarization of Hawaii. I forgot the fact to mention that I'm an elected official. I'm the only elected official from the county, state, and federal government who supports the Army's reduction of services. And the reason why is because when I ran for office, when I was 22 years old, it was because I promised to focus on the long term, on the bigger picture, not just what's most convenient for the next election. And so long as we are economically dependent on the military, the threat of leaving, the threat of you folks leaving us will always be imminent. 5 years from now, 10 years from now, my children are going to probably have to go going through the same battle 20, 30 years from now. And that's the last thing I want. Our congressman talked about kicking the can down the road. To keep you guys here, we'll be kicking the can down the road. We have seen this time and time again. In Lahaina, in the closing of Pioneer Mill on Maui, that's the island I'm from, we didn't focus on what's next. We focused on strongly opposing them leaving. We wanted to hold on to a waning industry. And what happened was a big battle, a big fight, with no plan, no exit strategy. And now there's just a big dust bowl over there and a lot of displaced workers. We need to focus on attrition, job attrition, land acquisition, cleanup, and housing, affordable housing development. Hawaii's congressional delegation and other agencies could create a substantial economic transition package to assist dislocated workers with training and employment, similar to what we do after hurricanes or other natural disasters. We should have short-term relief and long-term investment. And of course, there's the moral argument. We are a place of aloha, a place of okahi. But our economic livelihoods in Hawaii, we depend on ongoing war and strife overseas. Is that how we want to live? No. The economic impact of losing these troops will be felt, to be sure. But the economic possibilities give me hope for my children. To be able to have the freedom to choose their own destinies, to chart their own economic futures without the need for the federal government for the first time in the history of Hawaii. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Ma'am?
Aloha, ke aloha. My name is Moani Ke Ala Akaka. I'm from the Big Island of Hawaii. First of all, I'd like to say that my family, my immediate family, has over 160 years in the military and in the civilian military, the military civil service. So, and my son-in-law was a helicopter pilot from the National Guard, regular National Guard. He was there every day as a helicopter pilot, a Black Hawk pilot. So I've been asked to read and get on the record a letter to the editor that I had in the Honolulu Advertiser on Saturday. First of all, I would say that I am all, in spite of my military background and my family, I am all for the downsizing. It's about time. Cut the military on the Big Island too. I applaud the formation of the Oahu Council for Army Downsizing. Many on Hawaii Island feel Pohakaloa should follow suit. The Chamber of Commerce of Hawaii chooses to ignore President D. Eisenhower's warning concerning an unbridled military-industrial complex. One quarter of Oahu and one-eighth of Hawaii Island are under the control of military. These lands are some of the most desirable on Earth and deserve a more nobler use than training for war, death, and destruction. We desperately need to divert our economy away from relying on the military, which has proven to be an irresponsible steward, all you politicians. The State Department of Land and Natural Resources is being sued for allowing the military to degrade and desecrate Pohakaloa on my island. It has a constitutional duty to protect our natural resources and health. The United Nations Working Committee for Indigenous Peoples states that the military should not be desecrating our historic sites. You know, enough is enough. It's about time we practice more diplomacy instead of war, and more for the sake of our future generations. Our educational system is going down the tubes because of all the money that's being spent on the military. And another thing, whatever happened to those billions of dollars they were carting away on wheelbarrows over in Iraq? You know, we're saying enough is enough. And I'm saying this as someone whose family has been part of this military-industrial complex. My brothers were at Mare Island, they were apprentices, they were journeymen. One of my brothers even was working on a nuclear ship, unfortunately. But I believe in peace, and we're saying that is enough, and that the Chamber of Commerce should not be promoting with petitions telling people, sign up and get 17 of your friends to sign up too. Mahalo for listening, and take that back to Washington.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir, please. Thank you. I do think it's you did a very poor job of organizing this. It's not conducive to listening when you have all one side present in the beginning, and I hope you do a better job in your future evenings. I do support the reduction of the military budget as a whole, and reducing the military force here in specific. Other people tonight will talk a variety of issues, but I want to focus on the damage that the military has done, and the Army is in specific, to our land. And it is the damage is so extensive that it's not worth the price. That you folks need to clean up what you've done, and you need to leave and let us restore the land. What you've done on Koholawe is really unforgivable. The idea of bombing the land that you did and then failing to really clean it up in any meaningful way is really a disgrace. And it's not just Koholawe. At Makua, at Waikane, and what you're doing now at Pohakuloa, you know, you have the military has a lease with the state, and it requires, there's a condition in the lease, that after every training exercise, you folks clean up all the unexploded ordnance. You're required to do that by the lease. And not only do you have to pick up all the military debris, all trash needs to be cleaned up. You're not complying with the terms of the lease at all. There's military debris scattered throughout the lands that you lease from the state, and that's wrong. And you know your plan is to leave it. You're not going to clean it up. You never clean it up properly. And that is a price we shouldn't have to pay. Given the environmental damage you have done, there is a need to reduce your force, because the fewer you have here, the less damage you will do. And I think we all have to be concerned about what's going on with our water supply and what's going on in Red Hill. There's far too less concern. There's far too little alarm at the pollution of our water supply by the military. And you guys need to clean that up and stop what you're doing, because this is our home. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Next mic, ma'am.
My name is Sofia Kuule Rubio Estores. I'm 15 years old, and with me is my sister Sarah Malia Rubio Estores. She's 14 years old. We are in support of the Army's downsizing. As young Keiki, we hope and pray for the eventual demilitarization of Hawaii. We look forward to the day that the Army's soldiers are transferred from Oahu, and the precious land they occupy are returned to the people of Hawaii. This downsizing provides an opportunity for this to happen in our lifetime. If it does not occur during this unique opportunity, even our keiki will not be able to enjoy the return and use of these lands in central Oahu. We and other members of the community have collected signatures of Hawaii residents who support downsizing on Oahu. We had no budget, no celebrities, no politicians, nor any inappropriate use. Ours was a grassroots effort by regular people whose voice should be heard loud and clear. My sister Sarah already provided you this over 1,000 signatures. Mahalo nui loa for your time.
Thank you. Ma'am?
Aloha, my name is Sherry Pollack, and I strongly support the Army's proposal to downsize on Oahu. As made very clear, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of where it's best to downsize, and for several very good reasons, it's a win-win to choose Oahu. Many will probably talk tonight about training and Army readiness, all very valid points, One point many may not be aware of, though, is the negative impact that deployment to Hawaii has on military families themselves. Through my work, I've spoken with countless military families over the years, and most are very unhappy being stationed here. At first, they're very excited to be in Hawaii, but then the reality sets in as they realize that they're living in the most expensive, isolated location in the nation, and in particular, the great distance that they now are living from their family and their loved ones. Many military wives report being very lonely and depressed, especially when a spouse is deployed. Alone, they have to deal with the disappointment and challenges separation from their family brings as loved ones miss out on important life events, such as the birth of a grandchild, as well as many other important milestones in their family. So these stressors, including trying to manage in Hawaii's high cost of living, continue to build up. Studies have looked at this very issue and have found that depression in military spouses is very common and that it's a very serious negative impacts on both their mental health as well as the mental health and well-being of their children. Do we really want to perpetuate this unnecessary harm to these families and particularly to innocent children when there's an easy solution to this problem that has a multitude of other benefits as well? And speaking about children, what about the thousands of children from local families, families who cannot make ends meet and end up homeless as a result of the artificially high rent rates on Oahu that result from the inflationary effects of military housing allowances? Without that housing allowance in our rental markets, as well as the increased availability of housing once the military has been downsized, we will have the ability to make a significant step towards ending the tragedy of homelessness in our community. So in summation, I ask you to think about the children when you make your decision. Please look out for them and do what's best. They are counting on you to do the right thing. Please downsize on Oahu and relocate to a more affordable and more practical location. Now that's the prepared notes. I did want to make a comment to Mayor Caldwell's remarks that there wasn't really budget, that the whole idea of using military housing to help for low-income housing and for homelessness, that really wasn't viable. Well, I'd like to say that millions of dollars have already been spent enforcing laws that have been terrorizing the homeless. And if we stop wasting money on that and actually put it towards something like this, like housing, then we could find a solution. So that I just feel that's really important to point out. Thank you very much for your time.
Aloha ki a kua, aloha I kupuna, aloha nā makua, aloha kupuna, aloha United States of America, and aloha the people of Hawaii. My name is Leighton Sale. I was born and raised in Aupua Waiau, in front of Prahap. Blaisdell Park used to be our property. They condemned it to the wall. We had property from Honolulu Road to the shores of Prahap. The military took our home from my grandparents. They painted it military camouflage, and we still have the flagpole. My tutu band, tutuini, had to move to Punui, until the military gave us back our property, and they gave it back damaged. The camouflage paint, the floors were destroyed. I'm a graduate of Kamehameha Schools, class of 1967. I applied for all the training I had in ROTC. I was an officer in ROTC for 4 years at Kamehameha. Then I applied for all the military academies, because that was my goal. I played for West Point, I played for Annapolis, and I played for Air Force Academy. They put me on a waiting list. I was fortunate I got a scholarship, full scholarship from Calhoun MBA Marine Engineering School in Baltimore, Maryland. When I left Hawaii, I was scared. I'd never been to the United States of America, never. I lived in Baltimore, Maryland, and the times were tough. The war in Vietnam, the radicals, the Black Panthers, it's all going on. I thought, wow, what kind of country is this? I was scared. I went to school on the East Coast. I finished up in 1971 as a U.S. Merchant Marine officer, third assistant engineer, any horsepower, any tonnage. I worked my way up to second engineer, first, then chief engineer. Then, Matson Navigation Company had me get off the ships to run the operation Honolulu, head of engineering. I spent my first time in Vietnam delivering 11,000 tons of ammunition. We used to pick it up in Port Chicago. We bring it down to Luluole. From there, we go to Okinawa and we wait. All live ammunition, Agent Orange. Then from there, we go to Thailand, to Sihanoukville. We unload, and then they send us to Da Nang. We unload the heavy stuff. And then from Da Nang, we go to Vang Tau, we wait. Then they send us up the river, to Saigon, to the port they call Newport. For me, my duty was the United States of America. That's why I did it. I trusted. My na'au was strong for you. I studied your ROTC. I obeyed your rules. I did everything I could because I was proud. You made me proud that I was an American. I didn't do nothing about being in Hawaii. And I went to a Hawaiian school. It was hard, the transition. As I grew up and began to learn, and finally, my job was at Johnson Island to remove nuclear waste on the barges. That was my job. I had the Pacific region. They gave me Micronesia, Guam, everything. Anything dirty was mine to bring back after they burnt it at Johnson Island. Johnson Island, they tell me, don't touch the fish, certain fish. They call it BB. And I used to be, oh, and then a beautiful fish. So the marine life down there is still not stable, and that's part of the Hawaiian chain. I was so saddened. I was so saddened to see all of this, but yet I still believed in you. I believe you're going to take care of us. Our queen believed in you. She trusted in you. We got no treaty. There's no treaty between us. The missionaries came, they took our land, they changed our religion, they take away our language, that's war crimes. No more Hawaiian language. It hurt. I don't know how to speak Hawaiian, but my daughter teaches Hawaiian. Because our generation, we lost it because of Western influence. We trusted you. Our queen trusted the United States of America to protect us, our land. Our crown lands. You know how much that hurts? And I lived it. I lived it when they took our land, our family land away, and never got it back. Made it a park. Stuff like that hurts. But we swallowed it. My parents said, swallow it. I said, Mom, that's not right. That's right, too late. So you see, our aloha is strong. Strong in our pūvai, in our mind strong. Why can't you be strong in us and up front? There's no treaty. Be honest. You teach us in the schools and the religions teach us to be truthful. Your laws teach us to have justice. On your money it says, in God we trust. This is what you put in us. And we believe you. Well, as a kid, every time I got a $1, oh my gosh, in God we trust. And I put that down into the church box. For your religion was supposed to be supreme over my religion. So these are the facts that really you have to understand. We can talk about money, we can talk about, but we're not talking about the heart of our fucking name. It seems you try to give us, show us that you're trying your best to clean up the land. It's not happening. What about all the ordinance underwater at Koholawe? You gotta be touched and scared to touch. There's a lot of ordinance out there that's still alive. It hurts. And in the homes, the thing is, You know, you got these beautiful military homes for your people. That's Hawaiians, ain't got it. You first, we say it. Our land, we pay taxes so you can stay here. What do we do? So, I was thinking, today I was doing my, I started to do my federal taxes and state taxes. I told myself, I've been paying taxes to the United States of America for 45 years. And I didn't delinquent once. Not once, even to the state. I didn't delinquent once. I was honest, I paid it on time to the full value. Then I thought about it again, it's wait a minute. They are legally occupying us. So why can't we find an escrow company? We put our tax money into the escrow company. And if you want to pay your taxes to the United States and say, well, that's fine. But those ones who make sure that the truth come out, we put our money into an escrow company, we go to court, international court, and we ask for the truth and justice. If you win, that's your money. If I win, I'll come back. But it's fair, as the balance. You know, when you look at the court system, they get that one statue, look, with the balance. That's balance. Right now, it's how it is. It's not balance. If it was balance, and the United States of America was good to us, we wouldn't be filling this room up. We'd not be eating on the same table. Hey, how you brought up? We'd be enjoying each other's families. That's the problem. The problem is, you overdid it. You heard us. You heard us here, you heard us here, and you heard us here, and we cry. Until that is solved, then we can talk. So, the best thing we can do is have truth and justice in the International Court of Law. That's the balance. Let the United Nations and let Hague make the difference, because we're all members. I thank all of you for allowing me to speak on behalf of our people. Thank you. Aloha. Thank you.
Aloha kakao. My name is Mike DeWert. I live here. I live among you. I am a scientist who was working to get rid of landmines and unexploded ordnance and improvised explosive devices. I'm very proud of that work. It will make our men and women in uniform safer, but it will also make the entire world safer once we're successful and we can clean up some of this mess that's around in the world. I'm also very proud to be a citizen of a democracy. We are a democracy. We vote for our leaders, and unlike some of the countries on the other side of the Pacific, who cannot vote for their leaders, whose leaders are despots, will stop at nothing to impose their will on their neighbors, will not shirk from terror to impose their will on other people. We have a right and a moral obligation to protect ourselves and to protect our allies from those who would impose force and exploit weakness to take advantage. Our allies in South Korea, Taiwan, Japan, the Philippines, Indonesia, all over, Samoa, they depend on us. They depend on, look, our military is not only are we a democracy who elects our leaders, our military are volunteers. We're not a dictatorship that conscripts people. They volunteer. People from all races are in our military. People from all religions are in our military. Our military represents us, the people of the United States of America and of Hawaii. And I'm very... Yes, they do. If you do not vote in the election, and I'm very active in the Democratic Party in several caucuses of the Democratic Party. I was embarrassed to see that in the last election, not only did Hawaii have a historically low turnout for Hawaii, it had a historically low turnout for the entire United States. If people come and do not vote, they do not vote, and then they come and show such a lack of aloha for our elected leaders. We are a nation of people, United States of America. Everybody has the same right to vote. If you do not vote, and then you come here and try to shout down the people who were elected, that doesn't show aloha. That is not consistent with the values of Hawaii.
and it's not consistent with the value of the United States of America. We are here, I have lived here long enough to see the aloha that the people of Hawaii have had for the military. You look at the Great Aloha Run, you look at all the things that people do in Hawaii to make people feel welcome here, and you look at the aloha the military has for us. They're tutors in our schools, and yes, they do provide a lot of economic benefit to Hawaii, but that's not the reason they're here. They're here to protect us. They are the pointy end of the ihe that our own Hawaiian anthem speaks of. The ihe the leader wields to protect the people, and I'm very proud that the leader, their commander-in-chief, is a son of Hawaii, Barack Obama. And I'm very proud to have voted for him, and very proud to be from the state where he was educated and raised. And I believe that, I think that if we show aloha for the military, yes, there have been mistakes made in the past, but going forward, they are being good citizens. I'm in the Environmental Caucus, and I've seen.
You're talking about our land, thieves. Thank you. You're talking about our land.
I am a citizen of the state.
You're on the wrong state, wrong country.
Brother, brother, we are all citizens of Hawaii Nei. We all love Hawaii.
That's why you're Hawaiian.
I thank you for your display of aloha for people of all races and ethnicities and religions.
Thank you,
sir. I give 5% of my salary to charity. I give to the food bank. I volunteer.
Take it back to the continent.
Aloha kakao. Mahalo nui loa.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Please, thank you. Aloha kakao. And thank you for coming. Obviously, you can see the emotions that are in the audience. We do appreciate you being
proud
here.
Of.
And as the gentleman rightfully explained, we have the lowest voter turnout. What he didn't explain was that Hawaii, unfortunately, has a history of problems within our electoral system that the common people no longer believe that when you cast a vote in an electronic manner, that it's actually registered honestly, and that our voices in the electoral process no longer count. So unfortunately, whenever we have the opportunity to speak directly to people that actually can make a difference, we take that opportunity, and we really appreciate you coming all this way to hear what the rest of Hawaii Nei feels and thinks. As you can see, our elected officials are doing their job. They're trying to protect Hawaii. But there's some of us here that actually are considering what the nation, what the army considers best for itself. And it's really rare that we can have a win-win situation where you folks actually know how expensive it is to base one of your troops here compared to any place else in the continent. And I know this because I used to sell real estate. So we know, yeah, that the VA loans and the incoming personnel and the investment opportunities that people can live off base, buy a house, make big bucks and sell it when they leave, or rent it out. Because there's a lot of property managers who are really happy to do that. Yeah, we know. And so of course the real estate industry is gonna be against you guys leaving. But personally, because I have a hard time renting any place outside of my own parents' house, which is kind of embarrassing, yeah? Being my age, not being able to live on my own, because again, jobs, unless I'm gonna get a job with the military industrial complex, kind of rough. We all know this. That's why most of us gotta go. That's why there's more Hawaiian people in Vegas and California, in the Bay Area. Those are the two times where, again, the economy was real bad here. Yeah. So, that's why, again, they're doing their job, and you know, the businesses that do have the money, of course, want you here, because right now they're feeding off of the pork that Senator Inouye used to bring home. Yeah, and we know it's no longer coming. And in a way, again, it's a win-win, because I'm a farmer now. Yeah, so when the general here said that he is here for the people, I appreciate what he has to say. But you know what, honestly, I wish we could feed ourselves. I really wish the land, especially the 24,000 acres of grade A prime ag land that got banked at Schofield for future housing developments would be returned to us so that small farmers, once again, can grow the food to supply so there isn't going to be a food riot. And so that the
Military doesn't have to be called out. Yeah? That's our hope for our future, that our water supply would not be contaminated by depleted uranium or by other chemicals that, again, unfortunately, are coming out. I am a member of the Oahu Council for Army Downsizing, and I support the Army's proposal to downsize on Oahu. In fact, the Oahu Council for Army Downsizing does not believe the cuts on Schofield Barracks and Shafter go sufficiently deep enough to cut forces that would no longer have a mission once the two brigade combat teams are eliminated on Oahu. The OCAD does not believe the Army's combat and support forces stationed on Oahu are strategically located and readily available to support the national security strategy, a national military strategy of the United States, without immediately available airlift and sea lift to deploy these forces. The OCAD believes them to be isolated on Oahu and therefore a victim of the tyranny of distance in the Pacific. Moreover, the OCAD believes that the Army on Oahu lacks critically needed forced entry capability to allow it to enter hostile environments, a capability already possessed by the U.S. Marines presently on Oahu and throughout the Pacific. The OCAD believes taxpayers should not have to pay for redundant forces competing to do the same job, and redundant geographically isolated forces occupying critical lands and consuming valuable resources that are important to the state of Hawaii and the Hawaiian community. Example one is Makua. You know, yeah, that we've tied it up in lawsuits. You guys said you would do the environmental assessments. It never got done. It's still being tied up in uninvasive. And we celebrated 10 years of peace. No more fires being caused coming over Makaha. There's very few people here that actually live out in the most economically depressed area on Oahu. Yeah, I'm now living out in Waianae. Unfortunately, we see the homeless that come back from military deployments. They come live in our neighborhood, and we take care of them. We try. There's no suicide bombers, yeah? It's not that we're going to harm the military while they're here. This is Hawaii. We have a law. The hurt is still here. And we just want relief. We want to do what is pointed with a law. So thank you for coming to hear from us, the rest of Hawaii. We do appreciate you coming, but this win-win opportunity where you get to downsize and we get to try to rebuild life the way it used to be for future generations. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, General Flynn and members of the panel. I am Garrett Takara, and I am speaking on behalf of the Hawaii Regional Council of Carpenters. We represent 6,000 members of the United Brotherhood of Carpenters and Joiners of America and their families in Hawaii. We deeply are concerned and oppose a reduction of Army personnel in Hawaii, which would greatly be negatively impacted in so many ways. We also oppose the proposed reduction as an organization of skilled construction craft workers. We feel that we have been a partner with the Army in Hawaii for generations. For our side of the partnership, we have geared up workforce readiness and training to meet the needs of Army construction. We have maintained the capacity to build projects ranging from military installations to residential communities for soldiers and their families. In turn, our members have raised families and contributed to communities with their wages they earn on Army projects. The privatized military housing communities are an example of this partnership. The new and renovated family homes represent a major investment. Our union and industry stepped up to meet the need for skilled workers at the time of a booming economy. We're among union parties to the PLAs, the project labor agreements, that continue to guarantee no strike and foster smooth and efficient operations on the projects. In the Great Recession, hundreds of carpenters and drywallers at the time would have been out of work. If not for the Army family housing projects, they would not have been paying taxes, contributing to churches or charities, or even buying equipment for the Little League teams. As with Hawaii as a whole, we have contributed and we have benefited. It would be devastating if so much is taken away from the partnership that was built over generations. Again, we humbly ask you to reconsider and request not to advance the proposed reduction of the Harmony in Hawaii. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Sir?
I had something prepared for today, but I'm sorry, I'm taking off the gloves after how we were treated tonight. America has forsaken its principles. What happened to limited government and civil liberties? What happened to a non-intervention foreign policy? By the way, you're on foreign soil. What happened to one nation under God? By the way, that God that you supposedly worship says that they will turn their swords into plowshares. A nation will not train against nation for war anymore. The battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and authorities of the hidden world. Hidden darkness. These words must come to fruition, lest the punishment of Ahab be upon you.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am? Please.
Aloha. I'm Deborah Kimball, and I heartily support the U.S. Army recommendations to reduce Army personnel on Oahu by 19,800 troops. Certainly, there are many peaceful and healthy uses that increase living aloha for the funds now paying for death and destruction. Certainly, the Army will adjust, becoming more fit for the 21st century. Certainly, Hawaii's people and land and sea have borne far more burden of the U.S. military than our population and our environment deserve. Hawaii should be the first or second state to see troop reduction and land and sea recovery from the told and untold damage here. You will hear complaints that the jobs and other income attached to the 19,800 troops would be a disaster. Nope. No. Those are nearly all very localized economic impacts in three towns, and we are creative, especially our governor and our mayor, Caldwell, our local leaders, and we can search for alternatives as soon as you give us the word. I volunteer for that job. Our population has truly boomed since Schofield and Schefter began, and we definitely need all this island's very finite lands for more than 8,000 housing units and healthy economic activities, especially local food production. So we hope very much that you will also return several bases on Oahu. Controlling a quarter of this island's land makes the U.S. militarism so naked. Many of us dread bringing armed forces to the Pacific pivot. We want and need a Pacific Pacific. Some of us are sick of being Hawaii, the Hawaii spear threatening that Pacific. Hawaii has more than done its share in blood, treasure, and aloha for the United States. And what has the U.S. given back? Very little mercy and a lot of damage. Please reduce the troops and the lands that you took. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So,
aloha, and thank you for coming. My name is Dr. Keone Dudley, and I do favor downsizing. My concern is for the island and our people, We are standing at the threshold of another huge burst of growth on Oahu. 80,000 units are currently planned, most of them homes for newcomers who don't live here yet. Downsizing the troops on Oahu by 18,900 would rescue our island from this onslaught of building. The market will be flooded with so many thousands of empty homes that building huge housing projects will no longer make sense. The farmland the housing projects would take is some of the highest producing in the world. 45% of the Oahu farmland now producing crops for the local market would be lost in the next few years to these housing developments. If the housing projects are not needed, we can save this farmland, which we will one day need for our survival. We have some of the worst traffic in the U.S. on our freeways. The 50,000 scheduled homes in Leeward will put 50,000 more cars on our freeway. All studies say that we will come to a standstill. With downsizing, we could keep those cars off the freeway. High house prices and high rents are a huge problem. Many work two or three jobs in order to pay for them. With the many empty houses that downsizing would bring, house prices and rents will come down, easing our people's burdens. Downsizing is good for our people and good for our island. I strongly support moving all 18,900 troops. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am?
Aloha, I'm
Kaimi
Nicholson, and I support the downsizing. I respectfully disagree with many of the statements that our legislators shared with us tonight, and for example, there will not be quiet in those neighborhoods because many, many families will be very thrilled to move into those neighborhoods, and the mom and pop stores will be happy to have these new people there because they'll be shopping in their stores instead of the PX. So I think the economic problem that has been mentioned is nothing that we can't handle. It'll be actually advantageous in the long run for our economy. I would like to mention the price that we pay for educating the families that are in the military here. And I wondered why are all of our legislators so, all except for Kaniela Ng, so much against the downsizing. And my answer has to be the military-industrial complex that President Eisenhower warned us about. The money that they have, that their financial interest, has kind of distorted quite a lot of the information and perspective of many people because they have so much money and power to get their message across. And I myself am a member of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. You mentioned 9/11 this evening. And from my research, I have sadly concluded that there are criminal elements within our military and our outside of our military who conspired to create this horrible tragedy of not two but three towers falling on 9/11, and it was a controlled demolition, not yes. terrorists. And many more people are learning about this and understanding this and realizing that we have been deceived by the military-industrial complex yeah. for their own interests and their own gain of power and money, and as more of us recognize this and understand this, we are changing this, that they cannot continue to get away with this, that we, once we know the answers, once we understand that we've been deceived, that this will no longer be able to occur, and we will not have to have such a huge military budget anymore because those who are actually provoking us into war will no longer have the power to do that. And one last thing, military service, everyone here, I know you're all here for whatever your position is, you're all here for the good. You're all here for what is best. You want the best for our people. I understand that. I appreciate that. And military people know more than any other that sometimes you have to give up personal needs and desires for the greater good. And so I do appeal to the military to realize that the greater good here is to give the land back to the people of Hawaii, and we have a great need for housing, as you know, and we have very sacred land here that we'd like to not be devoting to military purposes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir? Aloha, and thank you for this listening session. What I'm here to do this evening, gentlemen, is to present a case for Army downsizing in Hawaii. Why the Chamber of Commerce of Hawaii and our congressional delegates have it wrong. As the discussion continues over whether the U.S. military will downsize its Hawaii-based personnel, Hawaii's congressional delegation maintains that defense is a critical economic sector for Hawaii. In a recent article from Washington, D.C.-based outlet, The Hill, members of the delegation talked about their strategy for regaining the defense and national security influence the Hawaii delegation once enjoyed under the leadership of Senator Daniel Inouye. Senator Brian Schatz was recently awarded a spot on the powerful Senate Appropriations Committee, once chaired by Inouye, while Senator Mazie Hirono was named the ranking member on the Senate Armed Services Committee's Sea Power Subpanel last week. In the House, U.S. Reps Tulsi Gabbard and Mark Takai have both been named to the influential Armed Services Committee, and both are Iraq War veterans. The Hill reports that Senator Schatz said the members of the delegation are pleased with the opportunities they have to shape Pentagon policy, including the pivot in U.S. military forces toward the Pacific. Representative Takai, meanwhile, is reported to have said, "I think it's very strategic to have all of our members focused on what matters most to the state of Hawaii, and one of the things that matters is definitely defense. I recognize that the delegation feels compelled to try to keep a strong military presence in Hawaii, but I hope they fail in that effort. If we adopt any perspective other than that of the small businesses who directly profit from Hawaii's substantial military presence, maintaining that presence does not make sense. Accordingly, the U.S. Department of Defense is advocating the transfer of 19,800 personnel out of the state. From the national perspective, even from a national perspective which emphasizes having a strong military, Hawaii is a very costly place to station troops. Compared to other bases on the North American continent, the training possibilities in Hawaii are substantially limited. There was a time when having ships and material assembled halfway across the Pacific meant a significant advantage for projecting our military force onto Asia. But today, that advantage has been greatly reduced. From a state of Hawaii perspective, we can begin with the taxpayer costs associated with the military presence. According to the Hawaii Department of Education DOE website, the average cost to educate a student in Hawaii is approximately $13,000. The average reimbursement for a federally impacted student is about $2,000, or 15% of the total cost. Hawaii taxpayers and the state government fund the remaining $11,000 balance. The website goes on to say that during the 2013 and 2014 school year, the state accounted for more than 28,000 federally connected students. 11,000 multiplied by 28,000 students gives us a current annual cost of $308 million, and that's after receiving the limited federal impact aid. Conversely, if Hawaii taxpayers no longer had to pay $11,000 per military dependent in our schools, we would suddenly be looking at a $308 million taxpayer subsidy. That is considerable. The officially approved point of view, which is pushed by our political and civic leaders, is that the military presence here is good for the economy. Rarely is it pointed out that every economic transaction has its costs
and its benefits. And those costs and benefits are not borne evenly across the population. It is difficult to find an honest cost-benefit analysis of the military presence here. The Military Affairs Council of the Chamber of Commerce serves as a semi-official public relations operation for cheerleading the military presence. But they represent that sector of business which benefits directly, and therefore they have little incentive to provide a balanced perspective which fairly reflects the costs and who bears them. Those of us who rent, especially near military base, are aware how military housing allowances drive up the cost of rentals dramatically. While that may be a plus for landlords, that advantage is negated by the huge disadvantage for renters. If the bases are downsized, the vacancies created in military housing will provide a significant boost in the supply of affordable housing for civilian renters. That would definitely be a plus. If the military decides to close down bases as part of the downsize, that will free up land for other purposes. The U.S. military controls over 20% of the land on Oahu.
25%.
That land can be put to productive uses which can provide jobs, housing, recreation for our people, and tax revenue for our county and state governments.
Food.
Which may be possible to afford an unaffordable rail. Though many base sites are contaminated with chemicals and ordinances, and the military will need to answer for cleanup costs before much of it could be repurposed. That is yet another reason to reduce the military presence and begin that process of reclamation. So while I do wish our delegation to Congress had more clout, as star advertiser political radar blogger B.J. Reyes calls it, in this case, it may be better for Hawaii and its people that they don't. In the past, when the DOD wanted to downsize the military here, Senator Inouye had enough clout to block those efforts, thwarting a decision which would have, in fact, been more cost-effective for the U.S.'s overall military posture. There are businesses located near bases which benefit from the presence of military families, bars, restaurants, and certain shops that offer things which are not available for sale on base. And there are contractors and their employees who benefit from military contracts. But increasingly, those contracts are being controlled by large national corporations that bring in their own crews from the mainland. The opportunity to diversify our economy so that we are not so dependent on the military will, in the long run, be worth reducing its presence. The businesses who benefit from the military presence and the Chamber of Commerce, which represents them, have raised a slogan: Keep Hawaii's Heroes. Save our bases. Our communities depend on it. This slogan blends together an appeal to patriotism along with a barely disguised appeal to a pecuniary self-interest. The slogan suggests that we are being disloyal, either to the nation or to our neighbors. If we question the net value of the military presence or see this as an opportunity to plan for an orderly transition from military dependence, because we are very likely to lose those 19,800 Army personnel. Perhaps it would be more prudent to draw up some contingency plans instead of insisting all loyal people should stick their hands in the sand and pray that this threat just goes away. I thank you for your time. And one more closing statement. There's a gentleman earlier who said that his job and responsibility was to clear unexploded ordinances and reclaim the land. And he mentioned that we live in a democracy. I don't know where he went to school, because when I went to school, I was taught we lived in a republic. And nowhere in the Constitution is the word democracy ever spoken or written. So we must understand our history according to the timeline of where we are today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Ma'am.
Aloha, my name is Raina Whiting. I strongly support the downsize. I am the director of In the Streets, which is a homeless outreach organization, and I also work at the Capitol. However, today, I am here as a community member. I want to share that my family is military. My father served in Vietnam. Both grandfathers and my great uncle served during World War II. Three of my cousins have spent the better part of the past decade in the military, which includes time in Afghanistan and Iraq. I love military because the military is my ohana. That means family. I want to remind you all that this opportunity does not have to be either pro or anti-military. I really want to focus on looking at this as a unique and one-time opportunity for our ohana and our community. If I had an hour, I could outline all of the reasons why this opportunity could positively impact our community and our ohana. But unfortunately, I only have 3 minutes, and I will adhere to that time limit. I work with our houseless ohana every day, and over the past years, I've seen a huge growth in houseless ohana that I assist and represent. Movoto did a national study that listed Hawaii as number one in the nation regarding the most homeless per capita for the last 4 years in a row. One potential positive impact this opportunity could have is on our housing, particularly affordable housing availability. One thing that we cannot argue is that the military has made a direct impact on the cost of our housing due to the high amount of the military BAH, housing subsidy. It is upwards of $3,000 depending on rank and number of dependents here in Hawaii. The proposed troop downsize could relieve the pressure on our housing market. At community outreach events here for our houseless, the public housing officials said that there is between an 8- and 12-year waiting list for our houseless ohana, and it has over 10,000 families on that waiting list currently. I urge decision makers to consider the positive impacts versus only the negative impacts that this potential downsize could have on our community and our ohana. I also wanted to add that I find it really interesting, while our mayor has stepped out, that he finds his rail project more important than upkeeping our infrastructure that could house Hawaii's ohana. And that while this is a democratic state, we began this listening session with politicians that 100% opposed the downsize. And the lone politician that publicly supports the downsize was not offered the chance to speak as a politician in that grouping. That was Haniela Ng, Representative Haniela Ng. Additionally, for you folks up here, it's interesting to me that a majority of our community members that have testified in support of the military downsizing. That is a stark contrast to our politicians up here that did also submit testimony. And I wonder, I ask myself, are they really representing our interests and what we want to see happen with this potential military downsizing?
Thank you, ma'am.
Aloha. My name is Kim Kompak, and I'm an instructor and graduate student at UH Manoa in the English department. And I just want to give a shout out to Kanaka Maole, on whose land that we're all occupying right now. I am so thrilled to be here and to be with so many smart people speaking truth to power. This is a unique opportunity, and I am thrilled to be here. I'd like to mention that I'm also a member of Decolonial Pinays, a group of diasporic Filipinos here on the island, committed to the demilitarization and liberation of Hawaii and all its peoples. I want to remind the committee of three facts we all know but seldom admit. First, while the military is credited with being a job creator and a vehicle of community life, in truth, it is the institution tasked with waging war, destruction, and death. Second, the U.S. war machine is highly profitable for an elite military-industrial complex, and it is that industry that has spun U.S. foreign policy completely and obscenely out of control. Third, the U.S. flag no longer represents democracy. It represents capitalism and a voracious greed for other people's oil, land, and natural resources. This idea that the military and even war itself is good for the economy and therefore cannot be questioned exemplifies the kind of morally bankrupt thinking that troubles me so deeply. It's time to reflect on Dr. Martin Luther King's words, quote, "A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual doom." It's not possible to ask dead soldiers whether it was worth it to sacrifice their lives to avenge 9/11 or to locate weapons of mass destruction that never existed in the first place. No, the dead cannot speak for themselves, so it's useful to think about those dead as we plan on how we want to live in the future. According to the Department of Defense, as of this month, the wars on terror, as they're called, have resulted in the deaths of 6,847 U.S. military, right? Twice how many died in 9/11, with over 52,000 people wounded in action. That's just on the U.S. side of the gun. Additionally, there are multiple epidemics growing in the U.S. military: domestic violence, rape, post-traumatic stress disorder, and suicide. According to the Department of Veterans Affairs, 22 veterans commit suicide every day, now outpacing combat deaths. In Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, deaths range anywhere from 174,000 to 655,000, with literally millions more left impoverished, orphaned, widowed, and displaced. And as our own Hawaii-born Major Antonio Taguba reminds us, tens of thousands more imprisoned and tortured. For all these reasons, I urge you to support this downsize and return those lands for an exclusively non-military purpose that supports human dignity and peace. Thank you.
Amen.
Aloha, mai kakou. My name is David Henkin. I'm an attorney with Earth Justice. For the last 17 years, I've had the opportunity to work with the Army on their environmental compliance at Makua and with respect to the stationing of a striker brigade here. In that time, I try and focus on the facts. I mean, and the facts that I want to focus on are your facts. So these are from your programmatic documents. I think that there, and then from other documents that the Army has produced over the years, as well as the General Accounting Office. So these are government facts. Decisions were made with respect to Army stationing in the 20th century, some dating back to the 19th century. And we have what you call legacy placement of a lot of your forces. We now have an opportunity with the downsizing to make a more rational allocation of the forces. And so I'm going to tell you some things that you know or you should know. Number one, you don't have adequate training lands in Hawaii for your existing forces. You constantly bring up this issue. There's not enough training land. Specifically for your striker brigade, it was a poor politically motivated choice to bring a striker brigade here. It's a medium armored unit, and you just don't have the maneuver space, and we don't have the terrain to accommodate that type of training. In addition to that, the lands that you do have are rich in biological and cultural resources, which is a gift to to not only the people of Hawaii, but to all the people of the United States and of the world. But for you, it's a constant headache. There are over, and this is your study, over 1,000 Native Hawaiian archaeological sites on your lands. That constrains your maneuver, it constrains your live fire training, it leads to all sorts of National Historic Preservation Act issues. You also have on your facilities 86 federally listed endangered plants and animals found here in Hawaii and nowhere else in the world. And you know exactly what that means for you and the constraints on your training to avoid the fires, the burden on your budget to try and outplant these plants and animals so that you won't drive them to extinction. You know all these things. You also know that despite the common rhetoric that Hawaii is a forward-based location for Army forces, that the world is round. And that unlike the old days where you generally deployed by ship, and where it might make some sense to be here, for rapid deployments, and you're trying to become a rapid deployment force, you deploy by air. And you also know that your air assets are not here in Hawaii. Your air assets are in California, Washington State, and Alaska. The most recent report that I'm aware of, and you may be aware of more recent ones, is this the General Accounting Office report from June of 2003, Military Transformation, quote, realistic deployment timelines needed for Army Striker Brigades. And it confirms that Hawaii is not closer to the areas that you want to deploy to in East Asia, or South Asia, or Southeast Asia. You actually get there faster from other locations because you don't have the airlift here in Hawaii. So they actually have to fly here, pick you up, and then fly over open ocean to get there. Last night I was having dinner with a Marine pilot, and I pointed out the fact that if you're flying from Washington State or California to get to North Korea or China or an ally in Japan, you're flying over land. You're flying over Canada, Alaska, the Koreas. That's safe. No one in their right mind would put a division or brigade on planes over open ocean if you had other choices. And what you are doing in this process is making choices, not for the Army of the 20th century or the 19th century or the 18th century, but the Army of the 21st century. And the facts are, it's expensive here, you don't have the training lands you have are constrained, and your land, you're sea locked. You can't get out of here easily. You'd be in a better position to protect our interests internationally if you were on the coast. Just a couple of quick comments for the people who are concerned about the economic effects in Hawaii. Again, this is the Army's study. And the Army's study says even if we lost all 16,000 soldiers, there would not, I repeat, not be a significant impact to sales or income. And that is on page 4-790 of their June 2014 supplemental EA. The significant socioeconomic effects are not from income, are not from income or sales. They are from employment and population. Well, the people losing their jobs and the population that's going down are not the people who live here. So, you know, there will be fewer people who don't live here living here. They will have fewer jobs. But in terms of the loss of employment and population, the people who actually live here and plan on living here and continue living here, it's insignificant. And as far as the sales and the income, the Army study says even if you lost all 16,000, it would be insignificant. Now, no one in this room, I think, really believes that they're going to downsize by two brigades. So if you look at their January 2013 study, it talks about the effects of losing one brigade, and I would respectfully suggest the Striker Brigade for the reasons aforementioned, which is you can't really train here, and you can't get them off the island if you wanted to. There, the sales volume would not go down by $1.35 billion. It would go down by $458 million, which sounds like a lot, but you have to realize that's in the context of a huge Hawaii economy, and that is not a significant effect. Even the $1.35 billion is not a significant effect. It's within the normal range of Hawaii's economic variation. And also, to our legislators, What undertaking would we subsidize with our land, our precious resources, that supposedly brings in $1.35 billion, but actually only pays $9.2 million in GET? That's because it's not staying here. It's going elsewhere. So if we believe that the highest and best use of Hawaii's limited land is for this enterprise, as opposed to feeding our people or increasing tourism opportunities or other things like that that augment our self-sufficiency, I suggest we should take another look at it, because a return on investment of $9.2 million in sales tax on $1.35 billion in alleged activity is not a good return. Lastly, on the housing front, and I'm sorry the mayor left, but the governor is still here, the speaker is still here, other people concerned about housing. Again, the Army's numbers. They can only house 40% of their soldiers with dependents, which means the other 60%, which are taking up the 2 and 3 and 4 bedroom houses that are not on the rental market, they live in the community. So the Army study from 2013 says, if you eliminate one brigade, you free up 8,000 rentals in the community. So, you know, if you're looking for a quick fix to housing the people who live here, who vote here, and who are going to stay here, I suggest you support downsizing a brigade. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir.
Hi, I'm Kimmer Bighorse. Onwe'oi from my tribe, my nation is from New York. I'm here to speak on behalf. I'm also a combat veteran. I did 36 months in theater in Iraq and Afghanistan, and I survived that. I did 10 years in the Army. I've been here since 2008, and I had a platoon of soldiers at Schofield, and I just want to salute you all for being here, and I think we're really in the same boat here, trying to figure out what to do with the future of Hawaii. I want to stay here, and as people have mentioned, the global war on terror is a very serious issue. You know, if there was a bombing here in Honolulu, you know, I don't know what I'd do. You know, I don't know where else to go, so this is like, you know, home for me. So I'll always be a soldier, and as the elite 1% of the American population, I think the United States needs to develop a relationship with the Kanaka Maoli. This land was like the Native Americans. It was, taken from. And their burial grounds, my ancestors, President George Washington sent an extermination order to annihilate my ohana. So what I ask, I speak for the Hawaiians that are not here, that live on Big Island, that live in Kauai, that where there's military, there's Navy everywhere. We should have the same dialogue with the Navy and with the Marines and with the Air Force. To malama the land, because that's why we're here. We're here to protect the land. You know, we're Army. We're supposed to be here for the land, and it's not happening. There's depleted uranium. There's no cleanup. I think the soldiers, when they come here, when military comes here, they should be briefed on the culture that this was a kingdom, is a kingdom. It's still here. And they need that training. They need to know what aloha is. They need to know what ohana is, what ha means. It means the breath of life. They need to have that mandatory training once they get here. Just a couple more things is like to reiterate what President Clinton, with the apology resolution here that he instated here. There's been no treaty. There's been no treaty with the United States. There's no agreement. So really, the Hawaiians here could really, you know, file a big lawsuit. So could the Native Americans against the United States, because this is their territory. This is their kuleana. This is their aina, this is their land. So perhaps open a dialogue with Kanaka about what the operations is here, help use the military to protect the people, the native people here, and like Tonga, like the kingdom of Tonga perhaps. Tonga is a kingdom. And if they need military support, you know, the United States is gonna go, Great Britain's gonna go, everyone's gonna have their back. Australia, the same could happen here. That's my suggestion. And that's about it. We just need reparations. We have, the main thing is Pohaku Loa. I physically marched from Hilo all the way to Pohaku Loa to speak to the military commanders there about the kupuna that are buried there in Pohaku Loa. And that, it's just, you know what I mean? Like, it's just like the military is here and just destroying the land, destroying graves and kupuna and bones, and it's just not right. So there needs to be a briefing why we're here, why are we doing training. We do it with the Iraqis, we do it with the Afghanis. I saw it, I worked for a task force commander. I saw them come in, we had humanitarian aid. There needs to be a reparation, some sort of restitution for what's happened here, Kaho'olawe, all the bombing and all that stuff. So that's what we gotta work on, because like everyone said, people are homeless. The ohana here is being destroyed. We need jobs, we need housing, we need, there's a child abuse issues, there's all sorts of stuff. Another point, just my last point, is would we do this to the Arlington National Cemetery? You know, like, would we bomb all our warriors, you know, that are buried there? You know, it's like, it's the same analogy, you know? So please consider that. The Kanaka know how to take care of the land, and they will very willingly brief you and help you, because we can work together to figure this out for the future of Hawaii and my ohana that I will have someday here, my future keiki. And as a Native American, we always look forward to the seventh generation. We don't look right now, we look seven generations ahead, and that's all I ask. So mahalo, I salute you. Thank you, sirs, ma'ams, and honored dignitary governors. And I wouldn't want to be in your position, because I know what being a leader is. So thank you. Seriously, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
My name is Travis Thompson. I'm a graduate student at the University of Hawaii in the Center for Pacific Island Studies. In this semester, we're going over the sort of the legacy of the military in the 20th century, and I'm telling you guys, this doesn't look good. I don't know how the semester is going to end for you folks, but I also wanted to share a poem, but before that, I want to add my name to the kids' petition to send you guys home. And then for you local politicians, the ones that actually stayed, hey, aloha, thank you guys for staying. I'll give you this poem. Actually, everywhere I go, I always give one poem to everyone. Everywhere I go, I was at Chaminade University last week, and every time I touch a microphone, I always give a poem to the audience. I'm gonna do two for you today. The first one's really short. I give this to you. I only ask that you take this poem, and you take this poem, you put it in your pocket, and you give it to someone else, all right? That's aloha, all right? It goes like this. Really easy poem to remember. It goes like this. But you gotta be dramatic when you share it, okay? I'm not playing. You Pentagon guys know dramatic, guy. It goes like this. Roses are red. Violets are blue. Some poems rhyme. Some poems don't. Thank you very much. That poem is yours. All right, and this is what I really came to do. I'm really tickled about the idea that the Pentagon's gonna be reading this poem. And I'm also, like, really, like, and I understand from a local politician's perspective, hey, Danny's dead, yeah, you know, yeah. And I brought plenty of money, and now you guys are scrapping over who can bring in the most now, yeah? Who can keep the most now, yeah? That's not the poem, by the way. And, I understand, you know, hey, 1.3 billion with a B, yeah, that's what Maisie said. Oh, yeah. Well, that's a big number, man. You know, I'm thinking, man, maybe you guys should get, like, royalties for American Sniper. That's 200 million right there. And then I was thinking, like, I was hearing the politicians talk about, sorry, these are just comments I wanted to make sure I got to, how the military is reading to our kids in the schools, and I was like, oh yeah, teachers do that too, But would I let the teachers go around and desecrate the aina? No, I don't think so. Would I let the teachers go around and you know, be the horrible stewards they've been and renege on leases for lands like the kind of land that this place is on? No, I don't think so. So, you know, you read to as many kids as you like, but as long as you don't treat the aina a certain way, we're not going to get along. All right. Poem goes like this. I also have family in the military. They're actually overseas right now. Because you guys. All right. It goes, sitting on the docks, fishing with friends, talking story. Reminiscing on times near forgotten. Conversation suddenly ceases when we see the monster approaching us. It was a moving island. Flying the flag of the U.S. war machine. It was an aircraft carrier. Ready to leave Pearl Harbor, Oahu, Hawaii, headed for the Persian Gulf. Instantly, thoughts explode. Emotions crash violently in the darkness. And in the silence of the docks, my soul whispers to the people of Iraq and Afghanistan, I say, I'm sorry, for the Americans are coming. In warships, steaming forward, acting on orders, laying plans of invasion, the Americans are coming. To export democracy through the barrel of a gun to a once sovereign nation, the Americans are coming. And they're calling it Operation Iraqi Freedom. And it makes me wonder for a minute on the meaning of the word freedom. And I wonder, who can claim the proper copyrights to it, eh? Freedom. Did you use it to describe the overthrow of the Hawaiian kingdom? Yeah? Did you guys free us? Na kanakamoni o ka'ena, the native people of the land? Did you liberate us? Well, 100 plus years since the overthrow of our nation, 50 plus years since statehood, now we're a minority in our own homeland. We used to be a proud people, lived off the aina, knew our history and culture, spoke with the tongues of our ancestors, navigated the Pacific by starlight with 20/20 sight on visions of what lay before us over the horizon. But then one day foreign ships came with the religions of Christianity, empire, and capital. And we died from the diseases of progress, the loss of land and culture. Dispossessed from ourselves and our history, we lost control of our future, and we died. By the hundreds of thousands, we died. And on the beaches, now owned by the military, in Honolulu, Wamanalo, Makaha, Waihole, Waikane, Makua, Pahakuloa, we are still dying. On waiting lists for lands once used to feed villages, we are still dying. In the backs of cop cars, prison cells, homeless shelters, rehab centers, we are still dying the slow death of an occupied nation. Like the indigenous peoples of North America were slaughtered for the lands they lived on and forced to live on reservations, the Americans came to Hawaii and made me a citizen. Naturalized by way of invasion, liberated in the name of capital. Thanks to military-enforced regime change, the occupied kingdom of Hawaii is now the 50th state of sorry affairs, where the cost of living is rising so fast, Nā kanaka maoli o ka aina, the native people of the land can barely afford to live. So is it any wonder why we are still dying? Enlisting our sons and daughters into Uncle Sam's armed services, hoping they can see college before they die. Receive affordable housing and medical care before they die. So that they can travel overseas to exotic places, kill them for their land before they die. So that America can claim another country, another island, another people, another aina, is just another resource. Exploited under the American flag. I'm sorry, I lost my place in the poem, but basically it was an anti-imperialist rant against capitalism, and I'm supporting the downsides against you guys. I'm really emotional right now. I just want to make sure that it is for the public record that you will add my name to the kids' petition. And thank you very much. Oh, and next time you do this in Lelehua, all right, if the politicians want to get up, let them. Just like everybody else who may have voted for you guys.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, my name. My name is Pete Buffer, prior service in this Army, combat medic. However, I stepped down from service when I realized I was just being used, not to fight for defense of the nation, but for economic and political interests. And then I found a better way to serve my nation through helping our kids as a teacher. At least I was trying. Just got three main points out of respect for people's time. And a quick comment about respect, too. I know that some are feeling that some of the jeering and yelling earlier was rude and disrespectful. But consider what you've heard tonight, that there is a lot of PTSD here. There's been cultural genocide here. There's been an ethnic cleansing process. So jeering, invading country, we're going to debate all day about what's rude and disrespectful. And just see where that came from. Yeah. No, I say that seriously, you know, out of understanding what happens with trauma coming from a military family. My first main point is a lot of people are making the argument that the bases should be here for our security. I question that. If you know history, which I did when I enlisted, so I made sure I used that GI Bill to find out what I was not taught in the DOE schools, is that the military actually has been a magnet historically for military conflict here to Hawaii.
Yep.
And whether it's North Korea pointing weapons at us, hello, it's because we got them pointing at them. And we only need to look at what you guys call Pearl Harbor. Pu'uloa to us was a primary example of a military invasion here. And that's all it's done is attracted more military conflict, which people in the military get used for. Second main point is that it's being argued that the military is here to secure life. Okay? Ask you to consider World War II. They had considered if the Japanese successfully invaded the islands, that the military had what they call a scorched earth policy, that they would burn down the islands so the Japanese could not do what the Americans were doing as a military deployment. I don't think that's taking care of the people. And I think that's where we're still going on. I live in Honolulu. I am surrounded, I'm not exaggerating, in every cardinal direction by military installation. And rather than being, you know, there's a boogeyman du jour, we have to worry about some invasion. I have to worry about the real, it's not a theory, it's very real, about my daughter's brain development because of leaks and Tripler and now Red Hill. Is a day-to-day concern I have about the safety of our drinking water. That's the security we need. We need human security. Now, this is really about political and financial security, if you hear the pro-military voices, which I argue is an insult. I did not serve in the military because it was good for the economy. And all those that are making the argument, that's exactly what you're doing, is exploiting the military because it's good for their economy. I'm not being anti-military, per se, not preaching pacifism. I'm being anti-militarism. And if you don't understand about being anti-military, military is reasonable defense of borders versus militarism, and economic, political exploitation of the military for policy, whether it's domestic or international. And if war solved all their problems, we would have world peace centuries ago, you think? Right? So, obviously I'm for the downsizing. This is obviously, and there's been a lot, I don't want to repeat what's been said before. What has been mentioned, this is historically, this is all about securing markets overseas. So let's not be honest. Let's be honest about this and quit denial. You know, you've heard some talk about Holocaust denial. There's something about the overthrow denial, about the Native, the Holocaust of the Americas denial. These are the stories you need to also add to the context here to understand what's going on. We clearly have this is not, like someone said, this is not democracy, it's a republic, and clearly what we have is a political machine. And they said, well, these are elected leaders. Yeah. The point that 40% of people voted is a statement of how broken our system is. So it's, as you look at our Princeton study, we do not have democracy, we have an oligarchy. Because we only have a minority really voting, getting being represented. So I was going to close with a Eisenhower quote, but already three people have evoked the industrial complex. So I'll leave you with another general. It's interesting how these generals don't speak up until after they left, right? Right. Eisenhower, and the one I want to leave you with is Smuley Butler, Marine Corps, two medals of honor. He said, war is just a racket. It's a scam. It is conducted for the benefit of very few at the expense of the masses. But this is not about politics. This is about my daughter's future. We got to do better than this. Politicians, since World War II, we've been counting on, I'm sorry, since the Depression, counting on wars to bail us out economically. That's not an economic system. That's an imperial system. And we want better more than that. And lastly, I'll just close with reminding you guys, because everyone keeps talking about the strategy. We're not a strategy, we're a community. Grounded and a divided one. All right? We are not a strategy.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Aloha. Thank you for this opportunity to testify. My name is Kyle Kajiuro. I'm with Hawaii Peace and Justice. We strongly support the proposed Army reduction. I think it's a necessary first step towards addressing some of these historical wrongs that you've got a sense of here today. You have a history problem here. The genealogy of the military's presence in Hawaii began with what was called by President Cleveland an act of war against a peaceful and neutral country. And so that basic fact hasn't gone away. The result of that overthrow is that today the military controls hundreds of thousands of acres of land,